Hey guys, this is Frank Yecker, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
Hey, this is Rich Franklin.
What's up, everybody? This is Chris Lieben.
This is Diego Sanchez.
Randy Couture.
Alex Overeem.
Hi, this is Stephen Bonner.
This is Don Frye.
Hey, I'm Phil, Mr. Wonderful Davis.
TJ Dillashaw.
You're listening to Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
You're listening to Submission Radio.
Welcome to Submission Radio. It's the 12th of June. Dennis Gratiff here with Casper Rozalowski, and we have a fun variety episode of Submission Radio for you guys this week.
Oh, yeah. Tons of fun and sexy guests. Kicking off the show, we're going to be speaking to comedian, you know, from MMA Roasted, Adam Hunter. He's going to be on the show. Bunch of things to talk about. You know, fun is the theme of the episode, and there was some comedy with... Well, a bunch of people, you know, like Matt Sarah, Dana White, and there was a big comedy special. We want to know the goss. We want to know what happened. And Adam Hunter's always got some sexy stories. So Adam Hunter's going to be on the show. Cody Garbrandt, I mean, man needs very little introduction. Knocked out Thomas Almeida in one round just a few weeks ago. He's going to be on the show to talk about what's next. Don Frye, I mean, the man finally got into... Well, he hasn't been inducted officially, but he will be getting inducted into the UFC Hall of Fame just after UFC 200. Luckily enough, we will be there, so we want to get the man on to give him his time and talk about his legendary career. Not to mention Dave Meltzer. You know him from the Wrestling Observer and MMAfighting.com. Dave always has tons of insight, and who better to digest the last week's worth of MMA news and action than Dave Meltzer? But wait, there's more. We've still got somebody else. Someone fun, don't we, Dennis?
That's right, Casper. It's been a serious few weeks in the combat world, so we've got a very special person to come around and make it bright for everybody again. Tommy Toehold is going to be making a quick appearance on the program. We're not going to spoil it for you, but it's going to be a lot of fun, and that's coming up on the show. And also, guys, make sure to stick around to listen to us answer your fan questions. We've picked out a few good ones, and we're going to be talking about them later on at the show. And also, in regarding to Tommy Toehold, don't forget to check out his awesome website, TripleTHS.com. He's got shit with his face on it. Make sure to go on there and buy it, and also follow him on Twitter at Tommy Toehold. The guy has hilarious tweets and is awesome to follow during fights that are happening, different pay-per-views, and a whole lot of other stuff.
Yeah, Tommy, funnily enough, Tommy and MMA Rose are two of the best follows you can possibly follow on the Twitter universe. And while you're being nice and doing things like going to TripleTHS.com and following Tommy Toehold at Tommy Toehold, you can follow us as well on Twitter at SubmissionAUS. I wouldn't say we're any kind of undisputed kings, but we do like to put up a lot of gifts and people seem to be enjoying them. So jump on there. You can follow us on Facebook as well. Completely different content to any other social media like our Twitter. Our Facebook is facebook.com/submissionradioAUS. And if you're feeling really, really nice, if you're feeling really generous, feel free to jump on iTunes. You should probably already be subscribed. If you're not, you should definitely do that. But if you're feeling really nice, give us a review. We'd be getting a ton of 5-star reviews. And you don't even really have to say anything. You can give a 5-star review and just put a full stop. We would take a question mark at 3 a.m. in the morning and be happy with that. So that's pretty much all the stuff you got to do. Oh, and also YouTube. Just got to mention that as well. Subscribe to the channel. I know some of you are probably watching it on the YouTube channel already. If you have any comments on anything that we say or anything that our guests say, by all means, chuck it down in the comment section below. And this is probably the best time to be subscribing because, you know, we are going to be at UFC 200. We are going to be at all the international fight weeks and all the fight nights and everything that transpires beforehand. Alvarez Dos Anjos, Joanna versus Gadea. There is going to be so much freaking content. The boys are running wild. We're going to be in Vegas and we're going to be getting tons and tons of content. So you'd want to be subscribed to our YouTube channel. And just a quick note, technique of the week. We didn't have one this Wednesday. We do apologize. We're sorry. We will be back next week. And we still have two more Sam Greco techniques before we transition to something new and fresh. So yeah, definitely stay tuned in for the technique of the week. Without further ado, that's enough from us. We're going to be cutting to our first guest. And Dennis, I believe, is on the line.
Okay, guys, you may know our next guest from his awesome stand-up comedy all over America, the head writer for the MMA Awards, host of MMA Roasted, and most recently, he's been playing a serious regular role in Oxygen TV's new docu-comedy series, Living With Funny. It's a pleasure to welcome Adam Hunter to Submission Radio. Adam, welcome to the program.
Hey, how's it going, guys?
It is great, man. Thank you so much for coming on the show. And I mean, we know you're a super busy guy, so we appreciate your time. Now, fans saw that there was a very special comedy edition at the Laugh Factory in Hollywood featuring Dana White, Matt Sarah, and Nick the Tooth, as well as yourself and David Spade. This is, of course, for shooting on the UFC web series Looking for a Fight. Tell us, what did you think when you heard that Dana was going to try his luck at comedy, and how did this all come together?
I got a call from the Laugh Factory asking me to host it, and you know, they said that they're doing it. They all wanted to try stand up, and I was more than happy to be on it. It was a lot of fun. It was I went to the Laugh Factory. I saw I never saw Dana so nervous. You know, you're so used to seeing Dana in his element. And he was sweating, and he was like, I mean, he was freaking out. It was actually kind of cool to see. But he did a great job. He had some really good jokes. He was funny. He was natural. Dean Thomas was great. You know, and I knew he'd be great because he's been doing improv a lot. So he joined a couple of improv troops. He did a great job. And Matt Serra, you know, Matt was like asking me for advice. I was trying to coach him a little bit, but I'm like, just be you. You know, it's like the first time on the mat. You know, you can't expect to start subbing black belts and stuff. You kind of just have to go with what you have. But Matt was hilarious. All three of them did a great job. I was more than impressed, and I was really happy for them. They were all like, you know, Matt said it was like fighting. It was like going through a fight, you know, because you go through so many emotions, you get hooked on it, and it was a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. Well, you got to be honest with us. We know you've written a bunch of things before. Did Dana try and get you to write jokes for him, or was everybody's material their own?
Everyone's material was like their own. I think that was the thing where they weren't allowed to get people to write jokes for them. I know that they had they met with Nick Swartzen and David Spade beforehand, and they might have gave them a little bit of a crash 1 hour course in comedy, but they all had to do it themselves, and they did a great job. I mean, it was you know. I would tell you if they bombed, but it was a crowd that was there specifically for them, though. It was a 6 o'clock UFC crowd, but they were having a ball, and the crowd loved it. And for me, it was hard because I got so high on that show because it was a sold out show at the Laugh Factory that every show since then has been a letdown, because it was such a beautiful and wonderful night. It was an amazing time. I mean, I wish I could report to you, oh, they sucked. It was horrible. The crowd was throwing tomatoes at them. But that wasn't what happened at all. I mean, I'm happy. I don't wish that. I'm happy that didn't happen. But, normally when comics talk, they're like, oh, man, what's the name? Bombed so hard. Or there was a fight on stage. Or, man, this heckler was horrible. But in this particular case, they all, killed it.
Well, talk to us about the heckler situation. You know, going into this, was this a concern at all that, you know, somebody was going to get really badly heckled and maybe not be able to come back from it like, you know, a natural comedian?
Not really, because, I mean, if you're going to heckle, you know, Dean Thomas and Matt Serra, you're not the smartest guys to heckle.
Yeah.
But I was a little concerned with the whole, you know, Ariel Helwani situation happened the day before.
Yeah.
So you never know. Somebody might have gone and been, said something about Helwani. But there was a couple Helwani jokes made that night. I'm not going to give it away because, you know, I want people to watch Looking for a Fight and stuff. But, no, there was no hecklers. And the crowd was super receptive. They were really, really – it was a very loving crowd. It was a very giving crowd. And I've been on plenty of shows where that's not been the case, where, you know, the people have their arms crossed and they're like, oh, you know, prove to me that you're funny. And you're just a negative vibe to get in there. And that was not the situation. They really – it was awesome. It could not have went better for everybody.
Well, we're curious because we know that you've been around the world and you've done comedy, you know, the biggest clubs all over the place. You've had a very impressive career, but we got to get a heckler story from you. What stands out to you as a heckler story that you had in your career that, you know, could possibly be the worst, the most interesting one?
I mean, there have been so many. you know, one of them, I got attacked. I got hired to do a wedding, and they told me to play the bride. I got hired to be the minister at a wedding, to be the official. And they didn't want me to tell the bride and groom that the bride and groom knew it, but not the audience. It was outside in a backyard in California, and they told me to roast people in the crowd, but they didn't give me anything specific. So I was like, dearly beloved, we're gathered here today. And then I just started making fun of the lady's boobs. Like, she had huge boobs. She was a Marine, and he was in the Army. And they were laughing their ass off. But the father was pissed. He was like, he was shaking his head like, this can't be happening. This can't be happening. And I started making fun of the best man and you know, the maid of honor. And then I started going into the crowd and making fun of people in the crowd. And this one guy got really upset. I said, you know, sorry. He was wearing, he had highlights, kind of looked like the head of like the lead singer of the Goo Goo Dolls. And I was like, hey, man, sorry your band broke up and something else. And the guy got up and pushed me. But the whole crowd is like Marines and like Navy people and Army. So then he pushes me and then storms away being pissed off. And then I got to do another 40 minutes. Like I'm only 10 minutes into my act. And I look over and the guy's pacing around. Everyone has their phones out. And then 30 minutes later, the grandmother starts yelling at me, going, we don't want to hear your sex jokes. Meanwhile, this is what I was hired to do. Mm-mm. You know, so that was probably the hardest. And then even getting paid, I had to wait another hour. And some people were like, that was the most hilarious thing I've ever seen. Come do my wedding. Other people were just like in shock. But it's actually going to be on True TV, July 5th, America's Greatest Weddings.
Oh,
you,
nice.
You can watch it on you can watch it on the internet. If you look up comedian attacked at wedding on like YouTube, it's got like almost 500,000 hits. That was pretty bad. And then there's this thing called the Montreal Comedy Festival where it's pretty much the biggest festival in comedy. Mm. And I got like 4 callbacks, like 4 years in a row where they call you back. And they wanted to see me. They saw me one night, like on a Wednesday. I had a great set. I figured I was going to Montreal. So I'm home. I'm relaxing all day. And they're like, hey, they call me. Can you come here in an hour and go on again? So I go to the improv. I'm like, they saw me yesterday. So now I go there and the host is bombing. The first comic doesn't show up. I go on and there's the whole crowd is like 30 old ladies that are on some kind of like bingo tour from like Reno to LA or something. So I get on and I go, hey, I like older ladies, because I was going to do a joke about like, who's your grandson? You know, because during sex, I could yell, who's your grandson? Mm. Well, this woman took a menu and hurled it at my head and hit me right in the head. She must have been like Nolan Ryan's grandmother because she had perfect aim. My head was swolled up, and I didn't need to say I did not get the Montreal Comedy Festival. So that was pretty bad. Those are probably two that come out like as far as worst. But there've been plenty more.
Wow. How do you come back from that? Like when a grandma throws a menu at your head, I mean, can you really come back at her? Did you say anything to her? Did you go down? Did you slap her around just to show who's boss? What happened there?
I did not slap her around. You know, I only had like 5 minutes. And I was at minute like 2, so I tried to ignore that happened and go back to jokes, which is probably the worst thing I could have done. I think I was young in the game, and so that was really bad. But I've been booed off stages, I've been heckled. It's just, you know, sometimes you have bad days at work. You know, the good thing about comedy is that you could always, there's always tomorrow night, or there's always, you know, it's Thursday, there's always Saturday night. Versus like a fight, you know, you can get knocked out in 7 seconds. And then you have to wait 6 months for another fight.
Mm.
So that's the good thing about comedy. But when you bomb on a big stage, that's when it's hard to come back.
Well, you're also known for, obviously, MMA Roasted, which is a great podcast that you do and really enjoy it. You also roast a lot of MMA fighters. I'm just curious, Adam, have you ever had a situation where a fighter got legitimately mad at you?
Well, Matt Serra blocked me because I said he had to lose 30 pounds to make heavyweight like years ago. And he unblocked me at our show. He said he was having a bad day. The only time I had Melvin Gillard got upset, you know, it's like I'll write a joke and then someone will tag the person I'm writing about, which always gets me annoyed because I'm like, come on, man. If you want to follow me, great. If not. So I wrote a joke about I said that Tim Bosch is so white that Melvin Gillard tried to snort him. And so somebody added Tim Bosch. Added Melvin Gillard. And then Melvin was like, what the fuck? And then I had to like DM Melvin and say, I did this thing. I'm like, I'm a fan. He's like, what kind of fan are you? And then once he saw the video of me making fun of everybody, it's like, sometimes guys get mad at me for not roasting him. Like I had Kevin Randleman on, rest in peace, Kevin. And, you know, he came on my podcast and he was like annoyed that I wasn't making fun of him. Like, I thought I was going to get roasted, not toasted. And he kept hitting me up on Twitter like, come on, man, what the fuck? Why are you not roasting me? So finally, I'm like, all right, I'm going to have a contest. Whoever can make the best Kevin Randleman joke. And I was going to give away some kind of award, like American Icon Autograph, like was our sponsor at the time. And all of a sudden, like 100 people started writing Kevin Randleman jokes. And then I got a text from Kevin like 10 minutes later going, all right, man, I promise. Actually, he called me. He's like, please make him stop. Make him stop. He's like, come on, man, uncle, tap, tap, tap. So that was really funny to have like the monster begging me to stop roasting him, you know?
Yeah. Adam Hunter taps out the monster. I got to ask you, because you've done so many of these roasts, which one stands out to you as your favorite?
I don't know, man. That's a good one.
Or even, you know? or even because you've done so many, like you usually do them for specific pay per view. If there's at least one specific pay per view one, you can be like, all right, that was the best.
I was working for the UFC. Like they were making the videos were through the UFC. Mm-hmm. So I don't do those anymore. But those were great because I got to actually have the guys come on that I was making fun of sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
It's like that was the best. I would say, I mean, you know, as a comedian, like your favorite joke is usually the last one you wrote,
mm-hmm.
you know, because you never want to think, oh, shit, like I'm done. I have no more jokes in me. So I wrote one on Monday night about Ariel Helwani tweeted that his ban was lifted from the UFC. He's now been banned again for tweeting that. So that like that one got like 500 or something retweets.
Did you go nuts with this whole Ariel situation? Did you have a lot of jokes for that as well?
I really didn't because Ariel was someone. There's only been a handful of people that have gotten sensitive about me roasting them.
Mm.
One of them was like Brittany Palmer got upset because I said more fighters pulled out of like 51 than Brittany Palmer, and so when she got upset, she came up to me after a show and she was like. I didn't even recognize her. And she was like, hey, you know, I work for the UFC. I'm like, no, you don't. She's like, I'm Brittany Palmer. And she looked a little different. And she's still hot as hell, but she just looked different from the last time I saw her. I was like, you're not Brittany Palmer. She's like, yeah, I am. I'm like, if you're Brittany Palmer, what type of tattoo do you have on your ass? Because I knew that she had lips. She showed me her lips. And I was like, ah, fuck, you're Brittany Palmer.
Oh, wow.
But so Ariel, another one, like I made a joke about how Ariel was going to replace Gargamel with the Smurfs and Ariel got upset about that. So then I stopped making jokes about him. You know, it's also like you don't want to kick a guy when he's down.
Yeah, yeah.
So the jokes that I would have made would be directed more towards the UFC than for Ariel, you know. And so that's where that goes. It's like I try not to make fun of people that – can't kick my ass, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's a good way to go about it. Now, let's go back to Dana and the stand-up. Now that you've seen the show, if you could give Dana some comedy advice, one piece of advice, what would it be?
Have more fun, you know? But that comes with confidence and experience. You know, he was so stressed about it. But that shows you how much he respects the art of it. You know, there are so many guys that are like, I'm the funniest guy ever. And they go up there and bomb. You know, he was terrified and he had a great set. You're probably a lot better off being terrified than you were being too confident. You know, advice on Dana. You know, I mean, Dana started talking. He had jokes about Bernie Sanders and jokes about the UFC and jokes about Matt Serra. So that was all stuff that in his wheelhouse. But just have more fun would be my one thing, you know, that just comes with experience.
Do you think now that he's done this, do you think maybe he should start opening up the post-fight press conferences with a few good minutes of material in the future just to warm up the media and the fans?
No, that's what I was trying to tell him. Like, Dana, why are you so nervous? You know, how many times have people hated you after a press conference? And he's like, yeah, but I don't give a fuck about that. he's like, those are my people. That's what I do. It's not really... my job, when you're trying to be funny, is a lot scarier than when you're trying to get information out. So that's where that was going. But he was a good, you know, he was cool. It was fun. But he was sweating though. I mean, he was sweating. I've never seen him so, you know, you never see Dana. He's in a position of power, or he's like really friendly, like really super friendly. And he was friendly, but you could tell he was like, fuck, what did I get myself into?
Mm. Oh, man. Well, I'm still holding out for a possible comedy show with Dana in International Fight Week. But before we let you go, Adam.
Are you going to be there, by the way?
Yeah, we'll be up there. So that'll be good. We'll be making our way.
Monday to Friday and Sunday at the LA Comedy Club. Do you want at the Stratosphere? You guys want to come?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. I mean, again, we don't know what exactly our schedule will be, but if we're free, for sure.
Yeah, we'll get onto Twitter and we'll DM each other. But before we let you go, Adam, we have to talk about this new show on Oxygen, Living with Funny. For fans who haven't checked it out, tell us about it and your role on the show.
So it was a docuseries about comedians, the life of comedians. And I was the only one who was single at the time. I have a girlfriend now, but so it was, basically they followed, like D-Ray was one of the comics they followed. He's living with two girls. He has two girlfriends. And then Michael Blackson has a girlfriend and like four kids. And Eric Rivera is recently married with a kid. And Brandon T. Jackson has a girlfriend. And I was single, so they basically went to one of my I went on a date with this girl, Gina Danger, who's a fighter, which went really bad because halfway through the date, I went and did stand-up, but not telling her that I took her to one of my shows. She was at a Mexican restaurant. So that went really bad. And then another episode, Brandon, thinks he could be in the UFC based on his Wii boxing skills. So I told him, I trained him, took him to an MMA gym, and told him I was going to get him a fight. So then I took him to my wrestling team, my middle school team that I actually coach at. And he got beat up by a bunch of seventh graders. That was another episode. And then on one of the episodes, I went on a bunch of dates with my exes to find out what I did wrong. And actually, one of the girls I went on a date with, who's not my ex, but we went on one date with Jessica Penny.
Oh, wow. That was,
yeah. But that went bad because when I went to reach in to kiss her, her 300-pound dog jumped on my back and then pinned me down and cock-blocked me. What are you going to do?
I think everybody wants to go on a date with Jessica Penne, so we envy you right about now, Adam, even if it was just for the show. But listen, you've sold it well. This sounds like an awesome show, so guys, make sure you check it out. Make sure to follow Adam at AdamComedian and at MMA Roasted on Twitter. And of course, check out his awesome comedy and support his new show, Living With Funny. Adam, thank you so much for taking the time chatting with us, man.
Can I say about my date with Angela Magana and Rowdy Beck?
Is this real life or is this in the show? Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you, no, this happened in like real life.
Well, wow. You lucky man. We have to hear about this.
Okay, so Angela Magana was fighting at in L.A. No, fighting in Vegas on the one that she fought when she fought the karate hottie, right?
Michelle Waterson, yeah.
So we were going back and forth on Twitter, just talking, yada, yada. So then she's like, it's not actual. She goes, hey, do you want to meet me and Rowdy Beck up in my hotel room after the fight?
Oh, wow.
She's like, bring alcohol. So I'm like, yeah. Like, why would I not want to do that? That sounds like a great time. So I go out and like get all this alcohol and maybe some other stuff, right? So and I was ready to go up there. She just lost, so I was cool. So I go to her hotel room. She's staying like at, I think the fight was at the Palms or the Hard Rock. It was one of them, right? She was staying at the actual same place she fought at.
Hmm.
So I go there. I'm like, this is gonna be the craziest night of my life. This is just gonna be awesome. This is gonna be crazy. You know, two hot fighters, and a comedian. Alcohol, this is just gonna be great.
Yeah.
So I walk in there and there's 27 fighters from the Ultimate Fighter Latino, Mexican fighters, laying in the living in the room with them.
So it's a gangbang.
Like, yeah, you got it. No, it was I mean, it was gang members. It was not the kind of gangbang I want. Yeah. And then they're there the whole fucking night. So I mean, it was fun. I got to hang out with Magana and Beck. But I got a fucking, I don't know, even though it was, I got Mexican catfished. Yeah, it was ridiculous. It went from a porno to Telemundo.
Wow.
Really quick.
Was it one of the situations where you rock up with the alcohol and then like all the Mexican gang members end up just drinking alcohol? Like, oh, thanks, Holmes.
That's exactly what happened. But the good news is I got initiated, which was good. I'm now a member of the gang. And which is good. I have like three tattoos now. I don't know what they mean because they're in Spanish, but I think one, you know, one says Maricón. So it's gonna be good.
Yeah, that's right. And the thing that you guys do as a gang is take photos of your ass and put it on Twitter. Part of the gang. But Adam, before we let you go, you mentioned a good point. You will be headlining a bunch of shows during International Fight Weeks. For all the fans listening who are going to be there, where can they check you out?
You can check me out, adamhunter.com. Check out my podcast, MMA Roasted, as well as Adam Hunter's World. I got a new show on True TV. They got True TV out there?
No, we may have it under a different name, maybe.
True TV is called America's The World's Greatest, which is the wedding show. And I just sold a TV show to a major network, so I'm working on that. I can't announce that yet, but that's really cool.
Mm.
And and then you can watch Living with Funny on Oxygen. It's still airing. So.
Well, there you guys go. He's the busiest man in comedy, and we appreciate his time. Make sure to check him out. And during International Fight Week, he'll be doing a bunch of shows there as well.
And I just found out that Michelle Old got hit by a car, and she can't work. So that she's a fighter, super sweet. I love Michelle Old. She was in Invicta and Bellator. So she has a GoFundMe page that you can donate to. GoFundMe. Please help her out.
Yeah, no worries. And we'll share that link on the Submission Radio Twitter as well so you guys can check that out. And please donate. Adam, thank you so much for your time. And we'll see you up there at International Fight Week.
Thanks, guys. Take care.
Hi, guys. It's Joanna Jędrzejczyk, UFC strawweight champion. Listen to Submission Radio.
All right, guys, our next guest is coming off a spectacular KO finish over Thomas Almeida just a few short weeks ago. He has jumped up in the bantamweight rankings to number 7. As they would say in Zoolander, he is so hot right now. Cody No Love Garbrandt, welcome back to Submission Radio. How are you, man?
I'm doing great. Excited to get off the river paddleboarding with one of my teammates and coaches, Justin Buckles and Taru. So he's off the river just in time to give you guys a call.
We heard there was the sea was angry today, my friends. Is that true? There was almost some near deaths.
We saw some crows out here. I think there were some blackbirds. I don't know. They're sitting on a tree. I just was paddling just to get back to the to the ramp to get back here. So it was rough and sore from it, but it was definitely fun to get out here on the river.
Oh, man. All right, well, we want to go back to May 29th when you knocked out Thomas Almeida. I mean, Twitter's blowing up. Everyone's talking about you. You're in Vegas. Tell us, what was the post-fight celebration like? Well, what did you do to celebrate the win?
Celebrate the win, I kind of just took it all in. Me and my coaches and teammates were kind of just, like, staying knocked out as long as they would let us. I remember we had to get ushered out because we were like, man, we're living the moment, you know what I mean, now because this is where we stay, really get really focused. That's where we get really focused, and so you can keep climbing the ladder. Then we just went to an after party. Had a little after party set up. My managers did. Went there for a little bit and just went home. Got something to eat. Went home.
Very nice. Do you think that if the UFC would have let you guys, you would have just stuck around in the octagon, maybe just partied there, invited a few people over, had a few bottles open, maybe put some music on?
It would get dangerous. It would get dangerous in there if we partied. But, yeah, I want to remember the octagon as a party. It's a real deal in there. So I try to keep it as, serious as I am in there. But, yeah, we definitely turned up at the after party. It was a good time.
I gotta ask you, Cody. The first time we spoke to you, you told us that Las Vegas was by far the best place to turn on Tinder. Did you jump on Tinder? You're in Vegas. Did you take a look around, see what was happening in the area?
No. I met an amazing woman about 3 months ago, a little over 3 months ago now, and we hit it off. And I'm enjoying life with her and these times with her now. And so I deactivated my Tinder. Things gone, and I'm happy where I'm at right now with her.
So for everybody listening right now, one less competition and Cody Garbrandt on the Tinder over there in the area. So I think you just made a lot of guys happy. It was tough to compete against you, Cody, in the area.
Good hair, good neck tie, man. All right.
Yeah, I think you probably had some good picks as well. But okay, let's talk about yourself there. You went from an unranked underdog to number 7 and an overnight star. It was very much like a coming out party for you to show that you're a force at 135. Do you feel like you've gotten a lot more respect after putting away Thomas Almeida in the first round?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, a lot of, Dominick's trying to pin a fight with me in Faber because I believe that he doesn't want to fight me. Dominick's not a dumb fighter. He's a champion for a reason. He's smart. He knows Tyler's to create the bad matchup for me. That's what I truly believe. So, I definitely feel like I got a lot of respect, obviously, jumping up the rankings, but really, rankings doesn't mean anything to me. I just wanted respect. They could rank me whatever. I'm coming to be the champion, and that's all I need that I focus on is winning that gold. And whoever adversaries in front of me is, taking them out and just keep climbing.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned Dominick Cruz, and I want to ask you about that night. Unfortunately, your teammate and mentor in Urijah Faber, he didn't go home with the gold. What did you think of the fight, and how difficult was that for you to watch him, fall short?
Yeah, it was difficult. It's when you're not in there, you can't control it. I'm more nervous than ever when one of my, teammates fight, people that you care about fight. So it was hard. It was hard to see that, I know how hard he worked to put, in this camp and wanting this win. He dedicated his whole lifestyle because he was 24 for these times. And, to come up short, it was nothing but a prom performance. 37 years old, he did amazing. I mean, he he's really practiced what he preaches, and I'm good to learn off of him.
Mm-mm. Well, in a lot of ways, it seemed like he was bowing out and making sure to promote you as a successor on his way out, because he knew he wasn't going to be competing for that belt anymore. Almost like a Jedi master promoting his apprentice. Do you think we'll see Urijah fight again?
I think so. We'll see. We're in a new gym, so he's focused on getting us moved into a new gym and keep improving everyone out here. So I don't know. He's got some things he's focusing on now, and we'll see in a couple months what he wants to do with his career. I haven't really talked to him about that. I know he's like he's focused on this gym, so he can keep us up and comers on Team Alpha Male. The new generation keep growing and getting better, and crushing all these records. So that's his focus right now.
For sure. Now, something else interesting that happened that night, there was a reported altercation that happened between Nate Diaz and Clay and Jason Guida. From what you understand, what exactly happened? Were you there in the middle of it?
No, I wasn't there in the middle of it. My coaches and stuff were, but I ended up speaking to Nate like right after the incident happened. I think Guida's, wasn't in his mind. He just got knocked out, gathering his thoughts. Wasn't all there, so it was kind of just, blown out of proportion, things happen like that, in the fight game. But I don't know, too much that went on, but it seems like, that's what it was. Clay was just not in his right mind after his fight and just said some shit, and he didn't respond to it too well.
Yeah, I mean, you spoke to Nate right afterwards. Was he chilled out? Did it bother him, or was it just sort of another day being Nate Diaz, and he just sort of shrugged it off his shoulder?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I can't really speak on Nate's behalf how he felt about it, but I wouldn't have been too happy either. I would have Nate did, reassess the what happened, and think about, he did get knocked out. He could have been in his right mind, but that's not me to say how he feels about it. I'm in Clay. Feel about it, but it's a little altercation. It's all good.
Now, we want to ask, just in general, you spoke about Urijah Faber, you spoke about, the new gym, and obviously you guys want to smash records. Justin Buckles, he's assumed the position of head coach, and he's been doing a phenomenal job. How is the team morale in general after, yourself winning, but Urijah Faber losing at UFC 199?
How's the morale? I mean, it's amazing in here. We're out here, back in the gym. Faber was just back in the gym this morning. Got Clay back in the gym training. The mix I've got Giroux out here from Japan getting ready for his next fight, whenever that's scheduled. Elkins is coming up. Everyone's in the gym. I mean, it's great atmosphere in there. We're having fun. We're having in season tournaments, like in-house tournaments, like just little competitions to keep us hungry, and just keep us motivated. And it's fun, competing and sharpening your skills with some of the best fighters in the world with the best coaches.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll tell you what, we've been following Taru and his experience at the gym, and you guys have seemed like you've been getting up to a few adventures, having a bit of fun there. I mean, he looks like a bit of a character. What are some of the fun experiences you guys have all done together that you can share with us?
He took over the Tinder now here. He took over the Tinder.
The new Tinder king.
He runs up to me with his, because his English is not very good, so the girls are speaking to him in English, and he's trying to understand the slang of, how Americans speak. So, he ran up to me with his phone, and he was like, help me. And so I could talk game to it for him. And then he's got a couple girls flying out here. I think he has four lined up.
Oh, wow. Girls.
He's hitting the ground running. No messing around with this guy. He loves the bitches.
So you got out of the game, but Taru's basically in the game, and he's taken over pretty much for you. It seems like he's just slaying it. But let me ask you something. When me and Casper help our friends out with the Tinder, what we like to do is we will swipe towards the attractive girls, but when they're not looking, we do like to go for some of the more, normal-looking girls. What's your strategy here? When Taru's not looking, are you jumping on the Tinder and making some, maybe not the best matches for him, but just for a bit of a laugh for the team?
The shotgun effect.
No, I haven't done that with Drew. I've done that in previous, but I thought it was pretty funny. Oh, my brother's Tinder and my little cousin's Tinder, but yeah, it's fun. I might need no love in the cage, but I'm all love out here. I got to share the love. So, I mean, and big girls need their loving too. Actually, Drew is here right now. He wants to say something to you guys.
Okay, Taru, tell us.
Yeah, I love my beach.
There it is. The new
Tinder. I'm paddleboarding for the first time.
The new Tinder king has spoken, and you're like his Barney Stinson.
He has spoken. He invites girls to cookie parties. Cookie party.
What's a cookie party?
Yeah, he's a character though, man. He's good. He works hard. He has fun. He, you know, all the way across, you know, from Japan, he adapted to us and our motto of enjoying the journey, you know, having fun, training hard. He fits right in. That's why I think those guys that come in from the gym and can do that mesh really well are going to be successful, and they get it. They get the bigger picture. He's one of them.
Oh, yeah. The bigger picture is more bitches equals life is better. Now, while we're talking about all this fun stuff, we just have to switch topics and ask you about something, something regarding Chad Mendes. You know, UFC just recently released a statement about Chad being flagged for a potential anti-doping policy violation stemming from an out-of-competition drug test collected by USADA. I'm just wondering, Cody, what was your reaction to the news considering Chad is such a huge part of the team?
Yeah, that's news to me. Like I said, I've just been on the river for a couple hours. Nah. So I didn't hear that first that I heard, so I can't really comment on that.
Nah, certainly. I mean, it did just come out recently, and yeah, we're hoping that it doesn't really have too much of an effect on the team. But from what you know about Chad, do you think this will affect him seriously? Will we see him fight again?
Yeah, I don't know what happened. I mean, what he's getting, you saw that stuff. You really don't know. So like I said, I haven't heard, like I said, but on the river, so I don't know. I mean, we've been through, deeper things that got back, so I'm not worried about the team.
Yeah,
gotcha. All right, well, let's go back to you. We saw that you said you wanted Bryan Caraway next. I'm wondering, why Caraway, and why is this the fight that you believe makes sense for you next?
It's a number of reasons. I believe Aljo would have won. I had to fight Aljo, so that's how it was kind of he was on my undercard, he was on my undercard, so the winners that, the winners of me and Almeida and Aljamain and Caraway, they were going to fight each other, the champions requested me to fight another ranked guy. That's Caraway's ranked 4. He had another request that I asked the general's permission backstage when we got in a little altercation, when I told him to polish, keep my belt polished. And he told me to get the general's permission, all this shit backstage. And, I must have forgot because the general just gave me his blessing before. He's making all the excuses, all these guidelines that I have to reach to be able to fight him. So I'm making sure that I, reach his request. But only request that I have for him is that he keeps it polished for me. And I'm coming. So that's all I can say on that. Okay, so I'm just the champion's request.
So you guys had a bit of a back. You guys had a bit of a back and forth backstage. What exactly happened?
I don't know. The guy just rubbed me super wrong. That's how he is. But it's a fight game. He's in my division. He's a champion. And I'm coming for what is mine. And he just beat my boy. So tempers are up. But I think when I get to fight with him, it's going to be great. So that's what I want. But he has requests for me. He has requests that he asked for me to do, and I'm gonna, accept those and tally him off until he has no more requests and he wants to fight me.
Mm-hmm. I'm just curious, before we do jump to Cruz and talk about a potential fight that could happen between you two, how do you see a fight between you and Bryan Caraway going? Because even though a lot of people aren't really high on Caraway in regards to his striking, he has made some really good fighters look sort of average. How do you see a fight between you and Caraway going? And are you worried about any of the aspects of his skills if you guys do match up?
You won't be in there that long to make me, make me look, whatever you said before. Mm. They make him look average. Good fighters look average.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what you said? Caraway's...
Caraway does have that ability, like with Aljamain Sterling, where he just, largely shut him down.
That was a combination of things, taking nothing away against Aljamain. But, Caraway's might have, fought fighters, had a lot of fights, but never fought a guy like me. And it's coming. I'm hungry. I'm young. You won't be in there long enough to make me look average. That's all I can say on that.
Do you think that because of this building rivalry and back and forth between yourself and Cruz, some of them have been public, some of them have been on Twitter, that you might end up getting the next title shot?
Me getting the next title shot? Yeah, but like I said, the champion wants me to fight on his request, so I want to fulfill his request and make sure he has no excuses when I represent.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about that matchup for a second, because obviously Dominick Cruz has really good footwork. A lot of people are really impressed by his unorthodox movements. How do you see a fight between you and Cruz going if it does come together in the near future?
That's another five-round fight where I flourish, right? You know, the spotlight's on, main event, world title. That's why I show up to fight. You know, that's the best me you're going to see. And it's, I'm just tapped into my potential. And, you know, give me five rounds to find his chin. That's even more of a percentage I'm going to find it. So I believe I'll knock him out. You know, I truly do. Stylistically, it's a great style for me. And I'm just, you know, staying ready for whenever that happens. Like I said, I've been mentally thinking of this dude for since I was a teenager. You know, thinking about fighting him, you know, when he was in the WSC, and that's no shit. Cause I knew I was going to be here. And it took a long, you know, route, ups and downs, a lot of adversity, so this is meant to be. You know, I truly believe this is destiny for me. And, you know, I'm just putting in the hard work, you know, and now I'm reaping the benefits. And just keep putting in the hard work, staying hungry and humble, and, you know, getting my shot.
Well, yeah, destiny. It's an interesting word because Michael Bisping used it a lot, and now here he is, you know, the UFC middleweight champion. And you did say that you've been visualizing being champion and knocking out Dominick Cruz since you were 16. What's it like for you to have watched Cruz in the WEC and then dominate in the UFC and now to be a potential front runner in the title race and that you might actually get that chance very soon? You know, is that a little surreal for you?
Surreal, but I mean, you know, I'm humbled because, you know, I worked hard to be here. So I'm going to keep staying humble and keep doing what got me here. But, you know, I eventually knew that one day that these fights were going to present itself. I just had to, you know, stay the course, you know, learn lessons on the way, and just stay true to myself and my passion. Don't lose passion, courage to chase this dream. And ever since, you know, I jumped in the MMA, that's what I did. So career maybe, you know, but finally it's here, I'm ready to go.
Mm-hmm. Well, in the UFC, obviously, your last fight with Thomas Almeida, you didn't really have much trash talk going back and forth. With Cruz, it seems fairly like that he'd engage in some verbal warfare. Is that something that you would have a positive effect on your performance? Would being fired up and fighting someone who you generally don't like sort of help you perform better?
Yeah, I mean, that shit don't bother me. I'm a fighter. I'm a born fighter. I mean, I like verbal altercation. That makes me more. Cruz, you know, it's getting into, I'm already in his head, so I mean, it doesn't matter to me if he wants to be a nice guy or an asshole and shit talking, do either or. Same outcome when I go in there, I'm still trying to rip your head off and be a savage in there, so okay, if you're nice to me, you're not nice to me. Same mentality going into it.
Cody, even UFC's going to Cleveland in UFC 203. Even though you're originally from Ohio, you've only fought there once, and that was in 2014. What would it mean to you to fight on or possibly headline UFC card in Cleveland?
You know, the headline is Stipe Miocic and Overeem, so that's a little heavyweight title. So that's awesome. Good for them. You know, it'd be amazing to go back home and fight. You know, I wrestled there, I played football there, my amateur boxing career there. And, you know, I come from like a blue-collar town. And, you know, some of the people might not have been able to afford the trip to Vegas or, you know, so it's a short little drive and, you know, they come out and support me. So we're going to pack the queue. So whoever is my dancing partner there, hopefully Bryan Caraway steps up and comes get this work. But I'm excited and you know, put on a performance in front of my hometown crowd.
Perfect, man. The event takes place on September 10th. That's enough time for you to prepare. Is it enough time for you to get ready for a potential 3 or 5 round fight?
Yeah, I mean, I stay in shape. I stay working out. You know, I'm already back in the gym. I got the best coach, the best training partner. So it's like when I'm away from that, I need MMA in my life to keep me structured and focused. And so I'm in the gym just crafting my skills to get better because I know these fights, you know, you're fighting higher level guys. That's what I want to do. So I'm just going to keep my skills improving and becoming better at each fight. And I've showed that in each fight. So, champions are built off you.
Yeah, perfect. All right, Cody. Well, as we let you go, we want to just find out some information about your new website. We saw on Twitter that you've got a new website for all the fight fans who haven't checked it out. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Oh, yeah. It's CodyGarbrandt.com. And my buddy owns a photo therapy or, you know, starts clothing, kid points, jewelry. So, you know, if you want to show some support and grab some gear up on there, that'd be appreciated. Make sure you take some pictures and tag it on, and I'll share it. I love support.
Well, there you guys go. Follow Cody on Twitter as well as at Cody_NoLove. And of course, his new website is CodyGarbrandt.com. It's new and fancy. Make sure to check it out. Go on there and check out his new t-shirts. Cody, thank you so much for coming on our program. Really appreciate it. We're happy that you survived the river, and we look forward to seeing who you fight next.
All right. Thank you guys so much for having me, as always.
And there you guys go, Cody Garbrandt. Always a pleasure having him on. And good to see that he actually survived the Sacramento version of Deadliest Catch. And even better to see that he is with Sacramento's official Tinder King. It's always good to have a Tinder King in Team Alpha Male.
That's right. Tinder loves white bitches. So people in the area, you know, jump on Tinder. You never know. You might get lucky. But Cass, it's been a sort of sad few weeks for MMA fans and the combat world, obviously with the passing of Muhammad Ali and also Kimbo Slice, tragically, at 42 years young. So, you know, we like to stay positive on this show. And even though there's a lot of negativity going on right now, we like to give it somebody, we want to give people something to be happy about. So we went into our dungeon. We had a bit of a think. We thought, how could we do this? And there was only one man who could do this. His name is Tommy Toehold. So ladies and gentlemen, here for you today to try and cheer you up a little bit and get you excited for what will be a very exciting few weeks of fights coming up in July. We've got Tommy Toehold's top reasons for MMA fans to be happy.
What's up, fight fans? I'm the 2009 John Travolta comedy Old Dogs of Mixed Martial Arts, Tommy Toehold. And it has been some week in MMA. There have been high highs and low lows. Things look like they're going to hell, and at the same time could end up pretty awesome. Like an AC/DC version of hell where your friends are there and everyone has electric guitars. But have no fear, fight fans. There are at least three things MMA fans can be happy about this week. So let me be your Samwise Gamgee and explain why there's still some good in this MMA Middle Earth. Number three, we won't have to hear about Conor McGregor versus Nate Diaz again in just a few months' time. That's right, fight fans. Amongst all the news this weekend, somehow, someway, a Conor McGregor story took the back seat, but it's official, and at UFC 202 in August, we'll finally get the rematch nobody wanted until it was taken away from us, and then we all wanted it super, super bad. And don't get me wrong, I am so psyched for this fight. The buildup is gonna be legendary. The fight itself is gonna be legendary. Tomes will be written and passed down for generations discussing just how few fucks were given on that day. But let's be honest, as an MMA fan, all the drama leading up to this thing has given me about six ulcers, and I'm just about done with that shit. So cheers, because in 2 months' time, this chapter will be done and written, unless we have a third fight. But let's move on to the second reason to be happy. At number two, Robbie Lawler exists. Guys, whenever you're having a bad day or you're worried about the future of mixed martial arts, just go watch Robbie Lawler versus Rory McDonald and bask in the blood-soaked, warm, fuzzy feelings you get. This dude leaves the UFC in 2004 and takes a nearly decade-long journey through MMA hell, suffering six losses and 11 wins. Then he comes back to the UFC and out of nowhere, he becomes the god of combat sports. He is violence incarnate. This man cannot put on a bad fight. He just keeps moving forward. He's like Jason Voorhees if he were a Terminator. And he's showing no signs of stopping. He's 34 years old, and he's fending off a stable full of killers at welterweight. He is everything that is right about mixed martial arts, and that's gotta make you crack a smile. But if it doesn't, I know this will. My number one reason to be happy as an MMA fan right now, Mark Hunt is co-maining the biggest card in the history of the sport. How did this happen, fight fans? The Super Samoan, the most liked man in the history of combat sports at 42 years of age after a devastating interim title loss, followed by another loss to the future champ, then a couple of thanks for the memories fights in Australia, finds himself in the biggest fight of all time against literally the biggest man in the world, Brock Lesnar. And better yet, he's a favorite, and he should be. Admit it, fight fans, if I told you last July that Mark Hunt would be headlining UFC 200, you'd have laughed me out of the room, which is more than I get for my show, so maybe I should start making bold predictions like that. But this has got to be proof that dreams do come true, fight fans. And if Mark Hunt main eventing UFC 200 doesn't put a smile on your face, nothing will. For everybody at Submission Radio, I'm Tommy Toehold. Thanks for listening to my horribly unsoothing voice, and be sure to check my videos out at youtube.com/Tommy Toehold. You can also follow me on social media. It is at Tommy Toehold for all of it. See you later, fight fans!
Hey, what's going on, guys? It's Demetrius Johnson, the UFC flyweight champion of the world, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
All right, guys, our next guest is a show regular who joins us here today to talk about his induction into the UFC Hall of Fame Pioneer Wing. I mean, it's needless to say, it's a super big pleasure to welcome Don Frye back to Submission Radio. Don, welcome back to the show.
Hey, partner, how you doing? Let me grab my underwear and I'll be good. Slip them on, I'll be good to go.
you don't need any underwear for this show, Don, so that's absolutely fine. Now, the world all over, and I think the galaxy rejoiced when they saw your name confirmed as an official inductee into the UFC Hall of Fame Pioneer Wing. Tell us, did you have any idea your name was being considered before you heard the news?
No, not a clue, partner. We were sitting there in my buddy's man cave, and we were drinking beer, smoking cigars, and watching the fights, and And they announced the first two, you know, Nogueira and Bob Meyerowitz, and they said the third guy, and they showed Dan Severn and I walking through the cage, and I said, them dumbasses, Dan Severn's already in the Hall of Fame. What are they doing, putting him in again? And then they showed me again and showed another picture of me. Holy balls, what the heck is going on here? So, I started. It got real cold in hell, I guess.
Well, there's been an outpour of support from fans online that were generally excited and happy with your name being chosen. We imagine that must be a pretty good feeling. How did it feel when you saw all of the support come in from fans as soon as they saw your name announced?
You know, I tell you what, partner, I was really happy. I got a real low point in my life, and it was real nice to be, you know, get that and pick me up, made me feel good.
Well, that's good. I mean, what does it mean to you to be inducted into the UFC Hall of Fame? After all your years of accomplishments, all years of fighting, what does it mean for you to be in the Hall of Fame?
Well, man, I tell you what, it means a hell of a lot. You know, I'd like to thank Mr. White and, the two Mr. Fertittas and everybody else who, you know, allowed me this privilege. And, I'd like to thank the fans and... it's a hell of a sense of an accomplishment, and I tell you what, I haven't felt this good in a long time, partner.
Mm-hmm. Well, you were the first UFC fighter to finish three opponents in less than a minute, and first to win five consecutive fights by finish, and your career also took you to Japan, where you fought in organizations like Pride and K1, you even spent time in pro wrestling, and now you're in Hollywood. We can talk about your accolades for ages, but in your opinion, what makes you a pioneer in MMA?
You know what? I was fortunate enough to have the time and the ability to do a bunch of different things. You know, I wrestled in college after that. I did a year and a half pro boxing, you know, Art Martori from Arrowhead and Sunkist, you know, the Sunkist Oranges. Art Martori owns, he's a sponsor for his Sunkist Kids wrestling team, and he sponsored me into fighting because he knew me from wrestling. And then I got out of sports altogether, and, you know, I went to horseshoeing school and fireman academy, and as a fireman, on days off, I'd shoe horses, and then started taking up judo, you know, because I was in a bad marriage. So, you know, I combined the judo and the boxing and the wrestling, and it just worked out great for me.
Wow, you're like a new age renaissance man. You'll have your ceremony next month in July, but the big question is, are we going to see a fancy new hat added to the outfit for the occasion?
Nah, same old hat. I'll just have to, you know, I think I'm going to take it down and get it re-blocked, you know, cleaned up for it, I can't afford a new hat.
Do you think it's only right that everybody competing during that fight week, both men and women, should grow a mustache as a sign of respect to you?
Oh, I hate to see the women. I mean, can you imagine Paige Van Zandt with a mustache? Holy balls.
still be attractive to us, Don.
I'll let her wear mine for a while, I guarantee you that.
All right, let's talk about your career.
Anywhere she wants to wear it, I'll put it.
Oh, man, the invite's officially out. Let's talk about your career. I mean, we say it every time, but, you know, you're a UFC 8 winner, UFC Ultimate winner, and a UFC 10 runner-up. Now that you're looking at entering the Hall of Fame, which one of those UFC events means the most to you and why?
Oh, hell. You know, they're all just as good as the other. You know, I mean, you can't really pick one above the other. They're just... Hell, have you ever fought three times in one night?
Only with my girlfriend.
Yeah. Yeah, I tell you, partner, it's a ball buster. And it was something that was fun, and only a few men did it. And fewer men were successful at it. And, it's a few people are in the Hall of Fame. So, shit, it's all pretty good. It's all a privilege and an honor.
Now, well, here's the interesting thing. UFC 10, right, where you knocked out Mark Hall and Brian Johnson, and at the time had a 6-0 record, actually took place on July 12th in 1996. Now, almost exactly 20 years later, because obviously the Hall of Fame induction ceremony will be on the 10th, you're being inducted into the Hall of Fame. Are you at all superstitious, Don? And when you were fighting back then, did you ever imagine that you'd be, you know, getting such a high honor and possibly, you know, at you know, the company's biggest event?
Yeah, partner, we all thought we were going to jail after the fights. We didn't think it was going to be this big. They're going to have a Hall of Fame. Criminy. You know, we're just happy to get a check that didn't bounce.
Well, there was the fight in Pride 2002, June 23rd, between you and Yoshihiro Takayama. It's still to this day regarded as one of the craziest fights ever. I'm just wondering, Don, after the fight, did you have any idea that that fight would still be regularly shared on Facebook and Twitter by fans 14 years later?
No, I tell you what, that's a hell of a thrill. You know, it really is, because there's a lot of people who've never seen it, and then they see it, and they're just bragging about it. And then a lot of people, you know, like, oh, I guess old Mr. White watches it once a week. You know, I mean, there's a lot of people that's their go-to. And, you know, I talked to some boys, Marines in Afghanistan, and they said they would watch a bunch of Don Frye fights to get charged up before they go out and shoot the enemy.
Wow.
Jeez, I mean, that's grabbing. You can't get a better, you know, a better honor than that, you know?
Yeah. I mean, you being the Patriot, that must be massive. Do you, you know, people who haven't seen that fight, I can honestly say they haven't lived. Do you think that fight is the single most iconic moment of your career?
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, I mean, God bless Yoshihiro Takayama-san. You know, it takes two to make a great fight. And if he didn't have balls big as church bills, you know, it would have never been that good of a fight. Mm. You know, he stood right there toe-to-toe and gave me everything I gave him.
Mm-mm. Well, you also worked and trained with a lot of MMA legends. If you could pin down one relationship that you believed helped elevate your career, who would it be?
Well, that'd be Dan Severn, of course. You know, Dan's the one who got me into it. He got me in the early fights before the UFC, and then after he won Ultimate One, you know, he went to the guys and recommended me to Bob Meyerowitz and Art Davies, and they said okay, and they threw me in the mix for, you know, UFC 8.
Mm-hmm. Did you get a chance to speak with Dan after your induction was announced? And if so, what did you guys say to each other?
Yeah, because Ant Evans, who's in charge of, you know, coordinating aspects of the Hall of Fame, he called me saying he's having a hard time getting a hold of Dan, and if I could chase him down, so. Well, the next day I got hold of Dan and I thanked him. You know, I asked him if he would, you know, give me the honor of inducting me into the Hall of Fame.
Mm.
And he said, yeah, he said it'd be an honor to him. So, you know, there we are, two guys with mustaches talking about the honor it is to see the other guy. And, and he's going to induct me into the Hall of Fame. So, it doesn't get any better than that.
I was just gonna say, two of the greatest mustaches on the same stage. I don't know how people are gonna react to this on the day. All you need is like Tom Selleck in the back somehow, and then the world will basically end. Now, speaking of July, your induction will be right around the corner from UFC 200. We gotta ask, of course, you know, the big news is the return of Brock Lesnar. What was your reaction when you found out he'd be coming back, Don?
Oh my God! Why? But you know, since Mark Hunt's going to destroy him, so, you know, it's going to be such a fun fight to watch Mark kick his head off. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
I mean, yeah, it's an incredibly stiff test to come back to, you know, after 4.5 years of an absence and fight Mark Hunt. Why is that? Why do you think Mark Hunt's going to destroy him?
Well, Mark's an animal. Crime, and he's one of your people, isn't he?
Yeah, we've claimed him.
We've adopted him.
Yeah, he's an animal. I mean, goddamn, he's one of the better fighters walking the planet, you know. And he's got the strength and the speed and the skill. And shit, he's like 10-foot tall and bulletproof.
I'm curious because a lot of people were saying, you know, Brock Lesnar would fight a lesser sort of a lesser fighter in the heavyweight division. Are you surprised that he's even taking Mark Hunt on, considering his weakness is the striking area?
Yeah, you know, I'm with everybody else. I thought they were going to give him some fish, you know. Who's that pro wrestler that keeps bailing out of his fight all the time?
CM Punk?
Yeah. I mean, you can see a punk, you know. There's somebody even worse than that. But, geez, I mean, I gotta give it a Lesnar for accepting the fight, you know. And, you know, first, you got to step into the cage first. And then, you know, then I'll give the guy all the credit in the world just for, you know, for being man enough to let that door close behind him.
I'm just wondering, I want to get your thoughts on one more thing regarding Brock Lesnar, Don. It's made pretty big news this whole week that normally when a fighter comes out of retirement, they need to go through 4 months of drug testing with USADA. In Lesnar's case, they have made a special exemption because he wasn't around for the rules prior, so he will officially have, I think, just a month of drug testing, or be open to a month of drug testing when he returns. What do you think about that situation?
You know what, I think the whole drug testing thing is a bunch of bullshit. I really do. I mean, come on. He's doing something productive. He's making money for the country, you know, for himself. Crime, you got people on welfare that are doing more drugs than the country of Colombia can produce. And, you know, they get a free ride. And why are we punishing people who are productive citizens? I mean, if he wants to do drugs, that's his damn business. As long as he's, you know, putting money into the country.
Mm-hmm. You know what it sounds like, Don? It sounds like you're sort of turning the corner on Brock Lesnar and almost sort of beginning to like him a little bit. Are we sensing the wrong thing here?
You know what, Lesnar's a hell of an athlete. He's a hell of an athlete. You're gonna give him that. You know, guy's an asshole, but you got to be an asshole if you want to be a successful fighter. You know, you show me a nice fighter, and I'll show you a loser. You know, Lesnar's one hell of an athlete. He's a big, giant, hell of a monster of a man, you know, crazy. And to come off a 4.5-year old layoff and fight somebody of Mark Hunt's caliber, man, that takes a hell of a man to do something like that.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's a good chance your paths will cross in July. If you do run into him and you could say one thing to him, what would it be?
No, hell. Buy me a beer, Brock. I'm thirsty.
Well, I think that's a beer situation that a lot of people would want to sit around and watch just to see the interactions. I mean, apart from your announcement, just a few other things we want to get your thoughts on, Don. You know, there was the big win for Dan Henderson, who turned his fight around against Hector Lombard and knocked him out in brutal fashion. What did you think of Dan's...
Yeah, that was a hell of a fight, wasn't it?
That was insane. I mean, you know, it was essentially one of those guys was going to get knocked out. What have you thought of Dan's career thus far and what he's been able to achieve?
I think he's done a great job, you know. He's 47 years old, and he knocks out somebody of Hector Lombard's ability and skill level. Crime, that's bragging rights. You know, I mean, they gotta give Dan a shot at the title before he gets too old to find his way to the cage.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's the interesting situation, because there have been reports that Michael Bisping would like to defend his title against Dan Henderson and avenge that loss that he had. Do you think that that's a fight that you'd like to see? And would you give Henderson a shot against Bisping in a rematch?
I would like to see that. I would like to see that fight very much. But, you know, there's an old saying, you know, the fighter becomes 25% better once they become the champion. And, you know, Bisping, he'll prove that. He'll be a much better fighter. And I think at this level in Henderson's life, I mean, you know, this Henderson's just, he got a little old, a little slow, and Bisping's peaking, you know. So I'd put my money on Bisping.
I got to ask you, because, you know, that's the constant debate with Dan Henderson. You know, he sometimes has some bad losses, but then he comes back and he has a big knockout like the one against Hector Lombard. You know, people are always debating whether he should walk away from the sport or if he should keep fighting. What side are you on? What do you think about that?
Well, hell, if you're still beating the people, why retire?
Yeah, well, that's a good point. I mean, short and sweet. Let's discuss this whole Michael Bisping win. I mean, it was something that a lot of fans didn't expect, him beating Luke Rockhold for the middleweight title on 2 weeks' notice after shooting a movie, no less. Were you shocked like us, and were you happy to see Bisping finally win the world title after so many years?
It pissed me off, and goddamn Brits, you know, had to steal my limelight. You know, they make that announcement that I'm in the Hall of Fame, and he has to go and steal the thunder from me. Goddamn, pissed me off.
Well, I mean, Luke, it's the response that we expected from you, Dunn. Luke Rockhold, he was such a huge, massive favorite going to the fight. What do you think went wrong for him on that night?
You know, them boys down there at AKA are a bunch of dumbasses. Someone doesn't know how to train them, or they don't know how to train themselves. Shit, they're all hurt. They're all hurt all the time, you know. So they pull out more fights than they compete in. So somebody's got to... You walk in there and take control of the situation because they're doing something wrong.
If you could give Luke Rockhold one piece of advice after this loss, what would it be?
Find a new gym. Find a new trainer. Get one that will protect you. Get new training partners, ones that will protect you. Back when I was competing, my training partners, they would sacrifice their bodies, you know, for me to make sure I got to the fight unscathed. You know, I was healthy. You know, if we were falling, they'd take the fall. You know, if we're sparring, they would taper back and they would take the punches. That's what you're supposed to do. You know, and that's what training partners pay to do.
Mm-hmm. Before we let you go, Don, the last few times we've had you on the show, we always ended up asking you about a potential fight against Kimbo Slice. Unfortunately, Kimbo passed last week at the age of 42. You've always said that you like Kimbo. I'm just wondering, what was your reaction to the news?
I was very sad. I really did like Kimbo. You know, like I said, I met him 5 years or so ago in Texas, and I was very impressed. The guy's a very nice, polite guy. Nothing completely opposite of what you'd expect. And, I didn't know if he wanted me to let that out of the bag, you know, and he liked the image of being a scary dude. But yeah, I was very sad when I heard that happen, man. Because I think he's an outstanding human being, and you know we lost another good person.
He may have not been an elite fighter, but he certainly achieved enormous high level of success and transcended the sport. How will you remember the man, Don?
You know, just like I said, he's a big scary dude, but he's the nicest guy on walking the planet. You know, I think that's a hell of a way to go out. Hell of a memory.
I'm just wondering, how do you feel knowing that you didn't ever get the chance to fight him? Like, you know, we'd always ask you on the show.
I never thought about it because that would put the situation on myself and be too self-centered. You know, I was saddened that he lost, that he died. Mm-hmm. Never thought about myself.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's been an emotional.
I know those people will say. I know what those people will say, well, what if I was there? What if it happened to me? Well, you know what? It didn't, and you weren't. So quit trying to get the attention to you. There's people, there's tragedy happening to those people over there, not you. So quit trying to get the attention to you.
Well, it's certainly been an emotional couple of weeks for combat sports with the passing of Muhammad Ali and also Kimbo Slice, but... Let's finish on a high note, Don. Now that it's official that you'll be in Vegas, to all the fans listening, what kind of present should they be bringing when they go and try and meet Don Frye in July?
Oh, bring me a big titty blonde or redhead, you know, with high heels and garters, stockings, you know, and a bottle of booze and some cigars, and, you know, and give me a room key with her and, you know, like... My wife we're going through a real bad divorce, so I'm looking for some loving right now.
Well, there you go. Don Frye needs a pick-me-up. Don, you'd be extremely disappointed if you ran into me and Dennis, because I don't think we'd have one of those on our hands. But there you go, guys. The word is out. That's what Don Frye wants. If you meet him, make sure to bring one. And he's already a legend. Now he becomes an official part of the UFC Hall of Fame. You guys can catch Don getting inducted live on July 10th. For more information, go to ufc.com/fightweek. Don, it's always a pleasure. Thank you so much for chatting with us.
All right, lady. apologies. Thanks a lot. Give me a seminar down there so I can get my ass down there to Australia.
Hi, this is Stefan Bonner, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
Our next guest joins us here to talk about some of the big news from this week in MMA. Wrestling Observer's and MMA Fighting's own Dave Meltzer. Welcome back to Submission Radio. It's great to have you, man.
Yeah, it's great to be here.
It's always a pleasure when you come on, Dave, and there is so much to talk about. But before we really get into it, obviously the world mourned one of the greatest of all time when Ali passed. Before we even get to MMA news, we've got to ask you what your favorite Muhammad Ali memories were.
I got so many because I grew up with, you know, he was like, Muhammad Ali and like the Beatles were like it, you know what I mean? They were like the most famous people in the world, it seemed like. You know, he was so much bigger than boxing and so much bigger than sports. He was just like this figure of, that, you know, I mean, very, very controversial figure. When I was a kid, he was pretty much reviled. And then, you know, when I got a little bit older, everybody loved him. And then he became, you know, just like this kind of a symbol of just the culture and, you know, this, you know, really loved, you know, greatest heavyweight boxer of all time. I mean, he was pretty much, whether he was or he wasn't, and he's certainly in the discussion for sure. You know, I think that in time, most people that were not boxing fans would kind of thought of him as the greatest heavyweight, or actually the greatest boxer of all time, just because of how big as a star and everything he became. So it was kind of like accepted. Oh yeah, he always said he was the greatest, and he said it so much, and he was pretty close to it anyway, that it was kind of accepted that he was the greatest.
Now, is it true that Ali was originally inspired to begin building his persona and trash talking after watching Gorgeous George wrestle in Las Vegas?
Well, the story is, I mean, Ali grew up in Louisville, and, you know, wrestling was, you know, in the 50s, and wrestling was around in Louisville to the point that it's hard to believe that he wouldn't have had some, you know what I mean, some background in watching it at some point. Now, it is true that in 61, which was right after, you know, shortly after the Olympics, he had a fight in Las Vegas. And I believe that his fight was maybe on a Saturday, and there was a Friday night show in the same building with Gorgeous George and Fred Blassie, and they sold out, and Ali's fight drew a couple hundred people, and they drew, like, you know, whatever it was, 10,000 people. So he's going, like, you know, and he was in a radio, he was in a radio station doing promos, or doing interviews, I should say, you know, to build up his fight, and George or Blassie, and it's very controversial because, you know, no one actually knows which one it was, were there before him. He always said George, except in 1976 where he said it was Blassie, and then he went back to saying it was George. And I would, you know, almost everyone has the story that it was George. The only problem is that if you, you know, I heard enough Blassie interviews and Ali interviews that it feels to me like Ali copied some stuff from George for sure, but he copied, like, it seems like five times as much from Blassie. So I think that he probably heard both, and it was really Blassie. But the idea is, without a doubt, he got it from and plus Blassie wrestled in Louisville a lot when he was younger. So he got a lot of it from the pro wrestling. And I mean, the irony of it is that he brought it back to the pro wrestling because superstar Billy Graham and Dusty Rhodes and Jesse Ventura and, you know, all the next generation of great talkers in pro wrestling, Austin Idol, those guys all copied Ali. And then when Hulk Hogan came, he copied Billy Graham, which was a copy of Ali. So really, like, everyone in some generation and form came from the lineage of Gorgeous George, Fred Blassie, then to Ali, then to Billy Graham, then to Dusty Rhodes, and on and on and on. You know, Ric Flair was another one just like that. So it's like they all kind of, I think that they all kind of got the same start, and Ali was probably the key in making it like something that everyone grew up watching, because everyone knew Ali a lot more than they knew the wrestlers in the 60s and especially the 70s.
And it's amazing. You go a few decades later and you've got guys like Brock Lesnar, Chael Sonnen, Josh Barnett.
Conor McGregor is a total copy of Muhammad Ali.
Yeah. But I mean, a lot of that does, in a lot of ways, come from pro wrestling. And these are some of MMA's most interesting personas. Do you think that, you know, more fighters...
Chael came from superstar Billy Graham and Len Denton. And so that's, again, that's the same route. You know, when Chael did those promos with the rhymes and everything, that's Ali.
Yeah.
You know, but I think, but it was more stolen from Graham than Ali. But Graham got it from Ali, so it's still the same source.
It's amazing. Do you think that, you know, more MMA fighters, from a marketing perspective for their careers, they maybe should look towards pro wrestling and building their abilities to speak on the mic?
Not today's pro wrestling. I wouldn't say that. I would say the 80s pro wrestling, because today's pro wrestling is very scripted and contrived, and I don't think that if you do that in an MMA fight buildup, I think it'll come across as really, you know, shallow and fake. But if you look at like the Ric Flairs and the Dusty Rhodes that really like spoke where they weren't scripted and it felt like it came from the heart and things like that, and learning, you know, not copying them, but learning how they did it. Yes, I think that'd be extremely beneficial.
Dave, did you see that Robbie Lawler interview that came out a couple of days ago where he said he'd take Conor McGregor's soul if they fought? I mean, I don't know. Like, usually Robbie, he's a pretty quiet guy, but I don't know about you, but I watched that thing like 20 times. Were you sort of in a lot of ways shocked that Robbie was able to sort of sell it like that? I mean, it was very eerie. I don't know what it was. Maybe everything was right in that moment, but it was crazy promo or answer or whatever. It was a crazy situation.
Yeah, I mean, I just think that he it probably wasn't something planned. It was probably just something, I'm sure it wasn't. I'm sure it was just like somebody asked him a question and that was just the answer he came up with at that moment that was, you know, an answer that everybody's kind of jumped on. You know, I kind of think this the same thing in the sense of, when Conor, you know, fought Nate at 170 before the fight and everyone's going like, if he wins, he's probably going to go fight George St. Pierre or Robbie Lawler. And I thought, boy, you know, George, I don't know, but I think it's a bad idea. Robbie Lawler, I know it's a bad idea just because of the style matchup, in the sense that, because Robbie Lawler can take a punch and Robbie Lawler hits hard, and it's just, you know, so much harder hitting than the guys that Conor's used to, that I just thought that, you know, I mean, he may be, and he is, I think that he's a more versatile striker and a quicker striker than Robbie Lawler, or at least, you know, the smaller version is. But, you know, size is very important, and Robbie Lawler, he just hits so hard.
All right, let's move on. Let's talk about what everybody wants to talk about. I'm sure you're probably dying to talk about it as well. Brock Lesnar's return to the UFC. As someone who knows his success in the WWE, were you surprised he chose to return at UFC 200?
A little bit. I mean, I thought that when he made the decision to sign the contract last year with WWE, that it was kind of like, okay, that's putting this behind him.
Mm-mm.
You know, because he was 37 years old, and it was kind of like, this is, you know, your window's closing, and okay, now he signed that contract, now your window's shut. You know, I know he was thinking about it. I know he did some training about coming back. I know the story that he felt that he wasn't, you know, his healthiest when he fought in UFC, and for sure he was bothered by the diverticulitis long before it came out, so he probably wasn't at his physical best. Now, if he is now, I mean, I don't know. I'm not in his body, so I don't, you know. It's like he's been saying for a while that he's completely healthy. I hope he is. That would be great. But yeah, I thought he put it behind it. And I know that there had been talk when he was going to fight, that he was going to fight Fedor. Mm. And that was legit. I mean, he was going to come out of retirement and fight Fedor. I mean, he was up for it. And Fedor was at one point up for it, but then Fedor decided against it. And, you know, after that, and decided not to come back. And then he came back and Fedor, you know, for whatever reason, you know, Fedor didn't, and his people didn't go with UFC, and UFC didn't try to pursue making the fight again, because it was years later. But yeah, when the thing broke last week, I was very surprised, and when they announced Mark Hunt as the opponent, I was even more surprised, because I thought that if he's going to come back, it's funny that when they said he's going to come back, I started thinking, okay, like, you know, maybe he'll fight Bigfoot Silva. Maybe he'll fight, I started thinking Frank Mir, but Frank Mir suspended. Frank Mir would have been the guy, but he's suspended. Okay, so I was thinking maybe Bigfoot Silva, or maybe one a lower ranked heavyweight that maybe he can beat, but even then it's a risk. And I thought, like, you know, the guys that he can't fight are Cain Velasquez and Mark Hunt. I just thought that those are the worst style matchups for him. Even more, Verdum would be tough, without a doubt. Stipe Miocic would be really, really tough. I mean, every top heavyweight would be tough. Overeem would be tough. But I just thought that the thing with Hunt, to me, that made it so bad was not that he has the greatest percentage of chance, or that Brock has no chance against Hunt, but that the risk is so high, because you know, with Verdum, I think that Verdum would probably beat Brock and he would probably catch him in a submission on the ground.
Hmm.
And, you know, Brock can tap out and it's like it is what it is, okay? But with Hunt, I mean, Hunt can knock his head off.
Hmm.
I mean, and, you know, and wouldn't be surprised if he did. And I thought that would be the fight. You know, Brock doesn't like to get hit, number one. But,
yeah.
And also, that's the kind of a thing that might hurt him in wrestling. Like, if he, you know, his whole gimmick in wrestling is he's the toughest guy in the world. And, you know, to be while you're wrestling, to represent wrestling, because he is, going over there and getting killed, you know, that's like a, you know, wrestling fans are, you know, some wrestling fans will be very upset at him for losing if he loses like that.
It's an interesting situation. I mean, we said exactly the same thing. I mean, Mark Hunt's an adopted Aussie, and we didn't think this thing was going to happen. Not a chance. Obviously, a lot of fans have always criticized Brock Lesnar because he had that fight with Randy Couture. A lot of people are saying he had an easy path to the title. Do you think the fact that he's taken on a guy in Mark Hunt, a guy that a lot of people believe will knock his head off, gives him a lot more credibility with the fans, maybe a bit more respect with the MMA community?
Well, look, Brock Lesnar deserves incredible respect of the MMA community because if you look at, I mean, people will say, well, you know, he was 5-3, but look at who he fought. I mean, it's like, okay, Randy was old, but he was still Randy Couture. Look at the experience edge Randy Couture had over Brock Lesnar. And Randy was still, I mean, he was still pretty darn good. I mean, like, he lost to Nogueira next, but he had a great fight with Nogueira before, you know, I mean, he had been off for a while. But, I mean, he was coming off, you know, a win over Gonzaga, where it was probably looked as good as he ever looked. It's like Randy wasn't an easy opponent. Frank Mir, in your first match, how many guys face a former world champion in their first UFC match?
Mm.
And then the second, like, you know, people will go, well, Heath Herring was at the end of his career, and actually was his last fight. But Heath Herring had so much, I mean, he had so much experience on Lesnar.
Mm.
And then he fought, I mean, like when he was champion, who did he duck? It's like Carwin was the number one contender.
Yeah.
And that's who he fought. He fought Mir, you know, again, who had beat him. And then he fought Kane, who, you know, pretty much in that time frame, everybody thought Kane was the best guy out there. So it's like no matter what. And then Overeem after that was you know, again, coming right off of Japan, where Overeem and Strikeforce, where Overeem was winning all his fights. I mean, he hadn't started his losses. You know, if you look at the guys, I mean, Brock, you know, he will fight anyone. I mean, he could have been, like, remember when he fought Carwin, and Carwin might have been 12-0 or 13-0 or whatever the record was, and he had all those first-round finishes. And Brock was just like, what does that mean? If I fought those same guys, I'd have first-round finishes. Why waste your time? I mean, he said, like, when he came to UFC in 08, he said, like, I want to find out how good I am. I want to fight the best guys. I don't want to be wasting my time 2 years, you know, beating up guys that I can beat.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to go in there with the toughest guys, and you got to give a guy credit. I mean, granted, he's a big, strong guy, and he was a great wrestler and everything. But, you know, I mean, and we've seen a lot. Look, I mean, like Steve Mako came in, and there's guys like that came in and that were as good a wrestlers as him that didn't do anything in MMA. And started in small organizations and worked their way up. Even Cole Conrad never fought anyone like the level of the guys that Brock did. And Cole Conrad was a great wrestler.
Mm.
And so, I mean, you got to give Brock credit as far as, like, he fears no one.
I'm just curious. Obviously, a lot of people believe Mark Hunt's going to beat him. Do you see a way that Brock Lesnar wins this fight? Or are you pretty much looking at Mark Hunt knocking him out here?
It's a heavyweight fight. I've seen so many strange things happen in fights. I just watched Bisping win the title.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's just like, it can happen. I mean, remember Melvin Manhoff knocked out Mark Hunt once. Who and how does that make any sense?
Mm.
You know, a middleweight. But it happened. I saw it. So do I say, you know, no chance? No, I don't say no chance. Is it possible that Brock can out-wrestle him for three rounds? Maybe. I mean, Brock was a great wrestler. But I certainly favor Mark Hunt in the fight.
Mm, I'm with you on that one. We definitely favor Mark in this matchup. I want to get your thoughts on this whole USADA situation where normally, obviously Brock's gotten the exemption, where normally fighters who are coming out of retirement, they need to go through 4 months of random drug testing. Brock Lesnar, he's been given an exemption courtesy of the UFC where he, you know, essentially he'll be getting about a month, almost exactly a month of drug testing leading up to this fight. What do you make of this, Dave?
Well, it is a controversy for sure. I mean, I know that their explanation and everything. I mean, but if you look at, it's not unprecedented. Yet at the same time, because of Brock, you know, I can see where people would be upset. I mean, believe me, I can see it. But if you're like, let's just say like somebody gets injured in 2 weeks on the UFC 100 card, and there's nobody on the roster that can fill the spot, they'll go to one of these organizations and they'll pick a guy up, and that guy will not have been drug tested at all, and come in. So it's not like it's, oh, you know, they're making a special rule. Now, the retirement rule is something that's different. But like even like some of those guys that come in, that come back, I mean, some of those guys probably may have been in UFC a couple of years ago. Now, the thing is, they did not retire, and Brock has retired, I guess, you know, like I guess in a, he retired twice, but the one time from UFC in 2011. And, the timing doesn't work, but I think as a general rule, I think that retirement provision is great. I would like to have seen it be put into effect here. You really would. And I would like to see, I would have also liked to have seen Brock have more lead time and promotion have more lead time and build up and everything. But I think that the whole thing with UFC 200, I mean, their loophole they're using is that, yeah, I mean, he did technically retire, but it's not so much, it was 4 years ago and these rules weren't in effect. So it's not like he retired to run away from drug testing, which he didn't.
Yeah, that's
not why he retired. Whereas you don't want a guy, you know, the reason that rule is you don't want a guy go in there and you know, just announce like after his fight, hey, I'm retired, so you can't drug test me anymore. And then like in 3 months go, hey, guess what? I'm out of retirement. I want to fight next month. Mm. And it's like, you know, while he's been, you know, using the stuff. So, I mean, but at the same time, I mean, it's like, Let's look at Brock physically, man. Last time I saw Brock, what was that, WrestleMania probably, right?
Mm.
Guy is enormous. I mean, I don't know what he is, 305 pounds? I mean, the guy is gigantic. So it's like, I'm not saying he's on anything, because he's always been gigantic. I mean, he's been gigantic for 16 years or more, 18 years. So, but you know, I mean, he's bigger than guys that are on everything in the book. So it's kind of like, you know, if there is a suspicion, I'm not saying that you know, having him be, you know, suspicious or suspecting him would be that out of line. So I mean, it's like with Overeem, it's like, you know, you really want those kind of guys that look like that. Your eye kind of tells you, you know, test those guys a little more than like, you know, James Vick or something, you know what I mean?
And that's exactly the thing. Like, you know, people have always speculated about Brock Lesnar, and it's almost like, well, beautiful, you know, we're in an MMA time frame or time zone where an era where we do have USADA and we can test guys like this. But one thing that I don't really like is that you've got the UFC, they can give the final stamp of approval. And they, like, on one hand, they are employing USADA, but on the other hand, they're sort of giving, they're the ones who have the ability to give the exemption. And I'm just wondering, Dave, do you sort of see this as a bit of a gaping hole in this whole USADA situation where you're right, like guys can come in on short notice and they haven't had those 4 months of training if they're coming from, say, another organization, but should they? And should there be a rule where, look, you want to save the card, and no one's more happy than me to obviously have Brock Lesnar on UFC 200, but, you know, should it be held to a slightly higher standard?
You know what? I think that, I don't like the circumventing of the rule. Mm. I think that, you know, maybe, you know, if it's 1 month, it's kind of weird. If it's been, you know, if it's 3 months and not four, I would probably go, well, you know what I mean? Well, yeah, it's not exactly the rule.
Yeah.
But, you know, UFC 200's coming up and there's millions of dollars at stake. But at 1 month, you know, it doesn't look good. I mean, let's be realistic. It doesn't look good. And because it's Brock, it doesn't look good.
Mm.
So, you would want, like, USADA to go, like would UFC want to do? Of course UFC would want to do it. It's got this big show coming up that they want him on.
Mm.
But, you know, you would want, like, USADA to go, you know what? I mean, if we want to have this thing be real, you can't make these exemptions for a drawing card,
mm-hmm.
especially a 305-pound drawing card. So it's kind of like, I am uncomfortable with it, yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's look at the card now. UFC 200 goes from a great card to, you know, possibly a major sporting event with Lesnar being on there. Do you think this has a good possibility of beating the UFC 100 numbers now that Brock's on the card?
Yeah, I think it can. Because people, you know, UFC big pay-per-views are doing better than ever before. Normal pay-per-views are doing worse, but it's become one of those things where when UFC has the really big show, they get all that ESPN coverage and mainstream media coverage. So it makes it bigger than ever before. But a normal show, people are skipping and waiting for the big, you know, they're waiting to buy their 2 to 4 to 5 big shows a year. So because of that, I mean, we've had a lot of shows that have come close to this. Now UFC 100 had Brock in his prime and also George St. Pierre together on the same bill, which was a pretty big, you know, double feature. But this, you know, I mean, Jones and Cormier is a really good main event fight. You've got the other two championship fights that are, they're not great, but they're still two championship fights. You got Cain Velasquez, and then now you got Brock and Mark Hunt, which may not be a championship fight, but I think that the intrigue of Brock not fighting after 4 years, and also remember, Brock's big drawing power came, he had wrestled in WWE from 2002 to 2004, and then he started fighting in 2009, I believe. Was it 2008 or 2009?
Mm-hmm.
2008, maybe. Which, whatever. So he'd only had a couple of years in WWE, and he'd been gone for 4 years. He's so much more famous now than he was then because UFC made him famous, and then WWE, he's been a regular character now for 4 years in WWE, so it's like it's modern. You know, it's not like, oh, by the way, he used to do pro wrestling. Now it's like he is a pro wrestler, and he's the second biggest star in pro wrestling right now coming into UFC. I think the novelty of a wrestler doing UFC is not as strong as it was when Brock first came in. But, you know, again, you know, a guy who's been gone for years and years and years, and then he makes a comeback. You know, it's like if GSP came back. I mean, there'd be a ton of interest in that. So yes, I think it's gonna. I think it'll beat the record.
Now, there's been some reports that Rousey will be a part of WrestleMania 33. You know, we've heard things about Paige VanZant as well. Do you think that this Lesnar deal will see a door open for more MMA fighters such as McGregor to be part of the, you know, different WWE shows? And is this a good thing or bad thing, you know, in your opinion? And also, is it a little surreal for you to finally see the WWE and the UFC, who have for a long time not really acknowledged each other, kind of working together and almost cross-promoting?
Yeah, it is kind of weird. I don't think it's necessary. I think it's cool for the they're different audiences in a lot of ways, and I mean, I don't see any reason why Paige VanZant doing WWE is any different from her doing Dancing with the Stars. It's just different forms of entertainment. So I don't think that hurts, like the idea of, oh, they're hurting their credibility. I don't buy that one at all. I don't think there's anything wrong with UFC people appearing on a WWE show. Now I think you know, so that's not so bad. I mean, now as far as you know, again, WWE people appearing in UFC, I mean, we're going to get Punk at some point, or we're not. I mean, you know, it's going to have to happen pretty soon or never at all, I guess. But, you know, Punk is a weird one because, you know, he doesn't have that background. You know, Lesnar, you know, obviously Lesnar had that legit wrestling background and he did well in the sport. I mean, so he's a very real MMA fighter anyway. I don't see anything wrong with Ronda. I was at WrestleMania 31 when Ronda Rousey was there, and I could say nothing negative about it. I thought it was a great moment for the wrestling fans. They went crazy. It was a nice skit. You know, you had The Rock and Ronda Rousey. I thought it was great for the WWE. I thought it was great for Ronda Rousey because she came in. I mean, it was a really to see her on that stage that night, it really solidified the fact that she's not just an MMA star. She's a real superstar. And if you can, you know, if you can show yourself in that audience like that and expand your audience. And again, I think, you know, when she came back to MMA after that, you know, it's not like, you know, her numbers went up and actually significantly, if you think about it. And I know when Floyd did Floyd Mayweather did the WrestleMania, I know from his management that the reason he did the WrestleMania, as much as like for a nice one day payday, was because he thought that if he was expanding his popularity to a new audience, it would help his pay-per-view numbers going forward. And I don't know if it helps that much, but it doesn't hurt. And it does make your name bigger. So anything that, you know, I think it's beneficial to make the name bigger in culture to do WrestleMania if you're a featured player. Now, if you're just doing a bit part and you're not portrayed as anything special on the show and you're just there, yeah, I don't think it makes any difference. But if Ronda Rousey's at WrestleMania, I mean, she'll be, you know, billed as one of the big attractions on that show. So I think it helps her in all her entertainment and in her marketing.
Mm-hmm. Do you think this is a sneaky way for the WWE, like in the back of their mind, to possibly get CM Punk to come back to the WWE, building a relationship with the UFC and hoping that maybe at some point they're able to get him back on while he's still fighting, if he is still fighting?
CM Punk and WWE's issues are very, very deep, and I don't think UFC and relationship will have anything to do with that. I mean, if they want him back, you know, it'll be up to him. And I mean, the thing is, he's very stubborn, and in his mind, you know, they don't specifically have a lawsuit against him, but they really do. I mean, their doctor is suing him. There's a lot of bad blood. He's really adamant that he's never going to go back. And, you know, I'm friends with Bret Hart, and I had many discussions with Bret Hart, and I'm not saying that I ever thought that Bret would never go back, but it was pretty, pretty heated, and maybe even more than with Punk. And he did. And I'm friends with Bruno Sammartino, and he went back. So as much as Punk always says that he'll never go back, I just keep thinking, you know, I knew people that just hated the WWE, and you know, what they still ended up, you know, mending fences years later. 15 years from now, well, you know, again, Punk will be pretty old, but he'd be in 52. But I think that the UFC relationship has nothing to do with the Punk thing. The Punk thing will be just if he wakes up one day and goes, you know what, my window's running out, and I kind of like this pro wrestling, and I can make a lot of money in it, so maybe I should just kind of forgive and forget. But he may be the exception. I mean, he's trying to tell people he is the exception. But so, yeah, I don't think this relationship has anything to do with Punk.
Okay, very interesting. And finally, before we let you go, Dave, as you know, Forbes released the information of who the highest paid athletes in the world are. And they reported Conor McGregor's pay, and they also reported Ronda Rousey's pay. I'm just curious, because someone brought this up online. I thought it was a good point. How does Forbes go about finding out exactly how much money a Conor McGregor or a Ronda Rousey made, when a lot of that stuff is kept private between them and the UFC?
Yeah, because you know what? I mean, it's like, I have no clue what the real number is that they make.
Mm.
And, you know, I don't know. I don't know what they did to get it, to get that number, those numbers.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, I know I've seen contracts of guys and their percentages and things like that. And I know, you know, within a reasonable estimation, you know, what the buy rates are of the shows that these people are on. But even so, I mean, that doesn't mean that their deals aren't better. Because my assumption is that Ronda Rousey and Conor McGregor's points on a pay-per-view are going to be higher than other people's, because they draw more than other people. Mm. And they probably negotiated a better deal. So if anything, I mean, Conor fought three times during that time period. If it's and I'm not sure what the time frame was. I saw the article, you know, the other day. But if it's like July to June, I mean, Conor fought Mendes, he fought Nate Diaz, and he fought Aldo. And I actually would figure that between the three of them, as much business as those three shows did, that you know, I don't know. I guess 22 million. Well, no, it's 18 and 4. 18 million from fighting. That actually sounded a little low to me. Ronda 14 million, but some of that's endorsements. I think it was a 10 and 4. So that would mean she fought Betch. She fought Holly Holm. And I think she had another. Was those the only two? Yeah, just Betch and Holly Holm, because she didn't fight again. So 10 million off of those two. That actually sounds pretty reasonable to me, actually. Mm. So I can buy that. I think the Conor number might be low, though.
Hmm. Okay. Well, it remains to be seen. And Forbes, they're sneaky and they get it again. Guys, Dave, we could chat to you forever, but we got to let you go because you're a busy man. Guys, make sure to subscribe to the Wrestling Observer newsletter at f4wonline.com. There is a ton of great content. And of course, make sure to follow Dave on Twitter at Dave Meltzer, WON, and look out for his fantastic work on MMAfighting.com. As always, Dave, it is a huge pleasure to have you on and be able to chat with you. Thank you so much.
Okay, very welcome. I enjoyed it a lot.
And there you go, guys. Dave Meltzer, everybody. Love chatting to Dave. We could literally chat to him all day long. Hope you guys are enjoying the show so far. We've had a lot of fun guests. A bit of a variety episode this week. And that pretty much concludes the segment where we have any guests on a show. We will be taking your fan questions in just a second, or answering them, I should say. You can send them in at info@submissionradio.com. That's returning in just a few seconds. But we just spoke to Dave a few seconds ago about this whole Brock Lesnar situation. I just wanted to sort of add my thoughts to this situation. Everybody's talking about it, this whole USADA deal, where normally, I've said it on the episode a bunch of times, but just to sort of clarify, normally if you are a retired UFC fighter coming back to active competition, you got to go through 4 months of USADA drug testing, random drug testing, and it doesn't necessarily mean that you will be drug tested, but you are open to it, and you're on the list, you're on the books, and if they want to test you in theory every day, then I think they can. Brock Lesnar's gotten the exemption where the UFC have basically stepped in and said, you know what, this is a special circumstance, we can waive that,
he only needs to, you know, the contract only just signed, so technically he was not a UFC fighter. He was off the grid. The contract just got signed. I think it was Friday of last week. Now that it's signed, and now that he's officially a UFC fighter again, he can be tested, which leaves, I think, a month and a couple of days, month for him to potentially be tested leading into UFC 200. And I'll be honest, no one's more happy than me to see Brock Lesnar fighting UFC 200. Huge Brock Lesnar fan. Dennis, I know you are, and I know most people are. I think even MMA fans who can't stand pro wrestling are super happy about this, but I have a big issue with this. I have a big problem with the fact that, you know, it seems like a small reason to give an exemption for. And the thing is, USADA has been brought in to sort of for everybody to take them seriously, but you got to remember, they are employed by the UFC. And if the UFC have the final say on everything, it's like a film director, a movie director who has final cut. If the UFC are the ones who are able to say, you know what, this is a special circumstance where we're going to waive these rules. These are the rules that have been set, but we're just going to waive them because, well, we deem the circumstance to be special enough. And if the UFC have that kind of power, I'm not saying USADA is useless or anything like that, but that's a big gaping hole in my mind. What do you think, Dennis?
Yeah, no, it's definitely a hole. And like you mentioned, we're happy to see Brock in there. But in a lot of ways, this is probably a good thing, in my opinion, because it brings a lot of attention and light to this issue. And I don't really think a lot of people are really going to talk about this otherwise, you know, if this didn't happen to Lesnar. So it's definitely an issue. You know, somebody's going to moderate the moderators. Somebody's got to keep an eye over this thing. There's got to be more hierarchy involved in it. The UFC shouldn't just be able to step in and do this. I think maybe even thinking about having some kind of separate exhibition type rules where if they do bring in fighters last minute, and I'm talking about, I don't know, guys like Brock Lesnar and maybe, again, they'd never do this, but like Ken Shamrock, these kinds of guys, if they put it under exhibition rules and it's different from the normal competition, so like it wouldn't be like a Mark Hunt, but it would be like a Brock Lesnar versus Fedor. Maybe they could figure out some kind of rule set around that. But I think in normal competition, and this is normal competition, even though he's coming back for one fight, he is fighting a guy like Mark Hunt, who has had to be a part of the testing himself, which makes it the whole process unfair. I think it definitely shouldn't happen. I think if you have two guys and you want to bring them in last minute, like, for example, you want to make a Brock Lesnar versus Fedor fight, both guys haven't been under the USADA rules, haven't been doing all of this stuff, and you want to bring them in last second, and both fighters didn't have to go through all that, you bring them in for like an exhibition type fight, and then you have a separate set of rules for that. But I just don't think it's fair to bring in a guy like Brock Lesnar who hasn't had to be tested all this time and only have 1 month of testing against a guy like Mark Hunt, because you and me, Cass, were always sort of trying to make things fair. You know, and in reality, life isn't fair, but it does seem like Brock Lesnar has an advantage over Mark Hunt in that area, and it just doesn't seem right.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I don't know what Brock Lesnar is doing. I don't want to sit here and speculate, but I mean, with pro wrestling, it, much like MMA, it's got a long storied history of steroid abuse, right? And who's to say that, you know, somebody, and we're not even talking about Brock Lesnar, anybody from the pro wrestling world may be doing something, may be on something. We've heard many, many WWE superstars say that the testing they have is an absolute joke and anybody can pass it. Who's to say that a pro wrestler in the WWE isn't, you know, on something and then coming in for some kind of fight in the UFC and they may be cycling off something, but they don't get caught because they've only got, you know, 30 days of testing. And especially a guy like Brock Lesnar, like we mentioned to Dave Meltzer, who people have always suspected. And again, I don't know the truth and I'm not going to sit here and speculate, but it's the perfect time to really, you know, at least try to find out. We know testing isn't perfect, but I think a lot of people would sort of be, not appeased, but a lot of people would be feeling better if, okay, well, we know that Brock Lesnar is going to go through 4 months of stringent drug testing. In that time, maybe he gets tested twice or three times or however many times. And then maybe, you know, of course, they test him on fight night, I think before and after, all that kind of stuff. And he still will get tested. I know some people online think that, oh, what, this means that he's not going to get tested at all. He still will get tested, but not for the 4 months like he should. And I think it's a huge, huge issue that the UFC are allowed to basically say, well, here's the exemption. They shouldn't have that power. I know they're employing USADA, but I don't think the UFC should be able to do that. I don't think they should be the ones. Maybe, Maybe the State Athletic Commission would be the ones who would give out the exemptions. We know that the athletic commissions aren't perfect either, but it's like if the promoter who stands to gain everything from it are the ones who are making the decisions and are handing out the exemptions, it's like they have the option to basically say, USADA, stand down. I know you guys are doing the drug testing, but stand down. We don't need you for this one. And I think that's an issue. And I know the UFC have taken the stance that basically, look, it's the same as if somebody is called up on short notice from a different organization to save a fight. I have an issue with that as well, because who's to say that, you know, that fighter hasn't been taking something, taking some kind of PEDs, they cycled, and then, you know, for the last 30 days or X amount of days, they haven't, or if they're being brought in on a week's notice, who's to say that they haven't just finished their cycle a month ago, and now here they come in on a week's notice? So I think that's another gaping hole in this whole USADA, you know, in the rules that fighters can be brought in last minute. I understand from the promoter's perspective that they want to save fights, and as a fight fan, I want to have those fights saved as well, but I don't think people should be able to come in on late notice. I think that if you are coming in, you know, from another organization, whether it's Bellator or somewhere else, you should have to go through 4 months of random drug testing.
Right, well, there you go. So I think the whole Brock Lesnar situation, easier to fix. The late notice replacements, the UFC will have to have a think about that one, but there needs to be a check and power. Someone needs to run the asylum, so we'll see what happens there. And I will say, though, even though this seems like an unfair situation for Mark Hunt, considering that he fought in Pride and he fought a lot of people associated with performance-enhancing drugs, at least Lesnar having a month of tests is a better situation for him than some of the previous fights that he's had in his career. And it's kind of funny to look at, but if you look at some of the guys that he's fought back in Pride, back in Japan, you know, he didn't even have that. So at least this is a bit of an improved situation, but I'm always against it when one guy has an advantage over another guy. So it's definitely an unfair situation. Hopefully people fix it.
Yeah,
get onto it, people. Do it.
You're a positive man, Dennis. I like that you can find the silver lining in anything. Yeah. Now,
well, I mean, look, the truth is, who would have known about this? You know, if this didn't happen with Brock Lesnar, how would we have known?
Mm.
You know, Dave Meltzer brought this point up. Did we really think about this before?
I didn't, no.
Not really. So hopefully when people listen to this show, they'll sort of listen to Dave's points and, you know, go back and improve it. Look, I understand the UFC are sort of trying to evolve this thing. So I hope that in the future they do evolve it. But I think just the whole bringing in Brock Lesnar and doing this thing, I'd only like this to happen once. I don't want to see this happen again. I hope you learn from this and that's it.
Yeah, I hope it's the last time. And especially when you're coming off the back of this whole UFC 152 situation with Vitor Belfort, where it seems like they knew he was on something, had elevated levels of testosterone, and they let it slide. It doesn't look good when you hire USADA and then you essentially tell them, you know, it's like having antivirus in your computer and then you turn off the virus, you know, the antivirus, and then virus to get your computer. Don't do that.
I hate antivirus programs. So to me, it's different, but guys, get onto it. And let us know your opinion in the comment section below. It's an interesting subject and no doubt about it. It's going to take some time, but let's fix it up. But Cass, you mentioned fan questions. What do we have today? Because I mean, we haven't been doing this for long. A lot of people have been enjoying the segment. We haven't had a chance to do it in the last episode of UFC 199, where Jeremy Botter on a lot to talk about, but now it's back. I'm excited to answer some fan questions, man.
Yeah, I want to bang out some fan questions real quick. And thank you to you guys for sending them in, of course. We wouldn't be able to do this segment without you. And if you want to send any in the future, info@submissionradio.com. Shoot us an email. You can tweet us @submissionaus. But email's the best because we can store them in a vault and do them either the next episode or at a later time. So, first one, Kyle Prios, the guy who's been listening to the show for ages. I saw Kyle's review on iTunes. Kyle is the absolute man. Hey, guys, his question is, hey, guys, long-time listener of the podcast here. We know. I've got a couple of multiple-choice questions for you. Pick only one of the following. Okay. A, you get 8 hours inside an empty Disneyland park for you and your friends to wreak havoc on. B, guided tour of Skywalker Ranch by none other than George Lucas himself. Or C, land a role as an extra in an upcoming Marvel movie with 15 seconds of screen time and one sentence of dialogue. Dennis, what are you choosing? You want to go to Disneyland? Of course I'd be there. Guided. Well, who else are you going to invite?
We'll invite all the MMA media. We'll invite all our friends, Jeremy Botter, Elias Cepeda, Errol Hawani, Luke Thomas, Robin Block. Can you imagine that at Disneyland? That would be crazy.
But everybody would analyze everything.
I know. Everybody would be trying to analyze, you know, what's that, Splash Mountain or whatever?
Yeah.
Oldest ride, longest line. Woo.
Yeah.
But yeah, look, for people that don't know much about my personal life, I really love going to the local theme parks here in Australia. There's one called Movie World, and I'm absolutely obsessed with it. So usually I would go with the empty Disneyland park. I mean, it just reminds me of that South Park episode where Cartman buys a park for himself and sort of runs it. But
yeah,
for me, it has to be C. I would definitely want to be in an upcoming Marvel movie with 15 seconds of screen time. To me, the perfect scenario would be I'd like to get killed by the Hulk. I'd like him to Hulk smash me.
Yeah.
And before he does it, I'd like to have a line of dialogue. The line would be something like, you big green motherfucker, something like that. And then he crushes me, kills me.
People would remember that. I love it.
It'd be like the Samuel L. Jackson of Marvel movies. Can you imagine this?
Except white, and you'd have both eyes.
And no one would really care about me.
Yeah. Look, I like the Disneyland park thing. I think that'd be fun. And I guess the best thing would be that there wouldn't be any lines. So I guess that's cool. Skywalker Ranch. Yeah, look, I like Star Wars, but I'm not like a Star Wars fanatic. I don't really know.
Either, guys.
I don't know anything about the Skywalker Ranch. Like the way you've brought it up, I imagine it'd be like, it's probably a big thing, as Star Wars fans would be like, oh my God, Skywalker Ranch. Yeah, nah, not for me. But I'd go see. I'd want to roll in an upcoming Marvel movie, probably something in a Deadpool movie, and I'd want to be some kind of mutant or even a bad guy, like a henchman that gets killed, but in like a really, really memorable way. Like, I don't care if he's slicing like 15 people all at the same time in a quick montage, but I want to be the guy that people remember. Or I don't know, something to do with Scarlett Johansson's character. I'd play her G-string and I'd talk as well.
Imagine that, talking G-string. Yeah, I mean, isn't it funny how both of us just want to die? We just want to die memorably. I think that's an extra's goal. I mean, if you're an extra that dies memorably, I think you've reached your potential. But also, Kyle, thanks for the review. Really appreciate it, man.
All right, Steve Justino, at what point was it in each of your lives that you decided to follow the career path that is MMA media?
Okay, so I know you and me have always been we've been fans of MMA for a really, really long time. And for me personally, we just saw that here in Australia and New Zealand, there weren't any shows about MMA. There was a show going on, but we didn't really quite know about it. So we thought we were sort of like the first show on the block. And we loved MMA so much that we thought, and we've done previous shows before. We had a radio show here in Melbourne. We've done a bunch of different things. So for us, it was a no-brainer that we were going to do it, I think, but it was just finding the time to do it. I'm happy that we did it, but it was sort of around, I want to think back to how long it was. I mean, this show, Casper, it's been going for what? We've been going for about 2 years.
Over, I think two and a half. March, I think 22nd, 2014. That was our first ever show with Alice Overeem, Tyron Woodley, and Mark Bocek. How's that for a first show?
I know, unbelievable. And I believe we were sort of sitting around, we were in a couple of jobs that we weren't too happy about.
Depressed, you could say.
Texting back and forth, and it just sort of happened organically. Like, I think we were both at the same point in our lives where we thought, if we're going to do this MMA thing, we have to do it now.
Mm.
And we didn't expect to do a show like this at all. We just wanted to talk a bit of shit about MMA. We thought maybe we'll get like a guest here and there. And there you go. Here we are.
The show that you guys see today, where, you know, we've got all these guests on, even just before, you know, speaking with Dave Meltzer and like all the other guests and stuff like that, it sort of happened over time. It wasn't really supposed to be what it is now. I'm glad it is what it is. And yeah, like, we had years and years of experience in radio. We had the possibility of going back to radio, but then we thought, you know, there's restrictions there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're on air, and that's fine, that's great, but, you know, like, if you want to do extra interviews or do things at our own time, if we want to have a 2-hour show or a 1-hour show or a 3-hour show or a 4-hour show, we rather have that kind of control and, you know, not have, you know, people in the radio world. And at the end of the day, like, really, here in radio, it's not like that many people in Australia, as far as like radio stations, care that much about MMA. So we wanted to sort of devote as much time, as much passion, as much interest as you know, we basically see fit, which is a lot, as opposed to having some bosses tell us like, oh, we don't want to run this story. We don't really care about this interview. And Dennis, you had a background in obviously TV and things like that, but despite all that, we figured, you know, online podcast, that's basically the best way to go about it.
That's right. And I mean, a highlight from our radio career is possibly when we did a one-off show of the Love Shack, where people called in and spoke about their relationships. it was a highly touted segment listened by hundreds and dozens of people that, you know, had a great time on it.
Did you say hundreds of dozens of people?
Hundreds of dozens.
We gave possibly the worst love advice ever. Basically, I think we were on break from our regular radio sort of whatever segment. But in radio, you know, people do pull out here and there, and they're like, hey, we've got an opening. And Dennis and I went for it, and we were like, what show are we going to do? We literally had no idea. We were like, we're going to do the Love Shack. We're going to give love advice. I think we caused more breakups than ever before in that week.
Yeah, we were like... We were pretty cool. It was a definite highlight. I think, who knows, man? I mean, we broke up some good relationships, and those people have gone on to be happy. So in a lot of ways, we kind of saved a lot of relationships. We're breaking them up. So this is good. This is good stuff here.
I guess so. I think we ended more marriages than Ashley Madison.
I feel like if we had a relationship with Don Frye back then, we would have ended even more relationships.
Imagine that interview. Don Frye, welcome to the Love Shack. Jesus. Follow-up from Steve Justino. Follow-up to that, if you guys were not involved in the sports media game, what do you envision yourselves pursuing as an alternate career?
Well, with myself, I really struggle staying in a job for more than, like I said, a period of time, more than a week, pretty much. I need variety. I need to do different things. I've been in jobs and I've just absolutely hated it. So it would be a combination of doing a little bit of marketing, advertising, maybe a bit of writing, a bit of more shows, anything to do with entertainment. I really love entertainment. I love coming up with ways to entertain people. So I wouldn't be able to be in a 9-to-5 job doing the same thing every day. To me, that's brutal. And I still have to do that at the moment. But it's not that frequent. It's just here and there whenever I want to do it. So we're lucky with the show we're able to do this for you guys. But yeah, certainly nothing as cool as this.
And the reason you have to do it is because MMA don't pay all that much. There are very few people who are, you know, millionaires or earning a ton of money in MMA. So yeah, I hope you guys understand that. Me, I'd probably be a professional gigolo, I'd probably be really, really broke. And you could barely call it professional. So I'd probably have like some kind of corporate job. And again, like you, I wouldn't enjoy it. I literally don't know what else I would do if I wasn't doing this.
Yeah, so I think you'd be a great gigolo.
Oh, thanks. I appreciate that. Yeah. Would you? But in saying that, you couldn't be one of my clients.
Well, you know, put on a wig. Things can work out.
Man's got to eat, you know?
Yeah, that's right. But I mean, look, it was Submission Radio. It doesn't have to be a MMA podcast. If this thing ever does fall through, you and me could just make Submission Radio a gigolo thing. It would be a gigolo partnership where basically we'd break down the clients down the middle.
You guys,
the bigger ones can go your way, and the ones with all their limbs can go my way.
Hey, I don't need these bigger ones,
all right? All their limbs.
You know what's funny, though? You guys have no idea how many emails, how many follows on Twitter we get.
Yes.
Because it's called Submission Radio, from like Bondage and BDSM and like all these, what do you call them? The people,
dominatrix, that
are, dominatrixes.
People.
Yeah,
I don't have the heart to tell them sometimes. You know, sometimes I just let them follow us. And I think sometimes when they see us interviewing Johnny Hendrix, they think it's a bit kinky, but it's not. It's not. I promise. We did have Cleo Valentine on once when that Ronda Rousey porno came out,
and I think that confirmed it. Like, I think they maybe thought, oh, they are a bondage show, but they're just kind of, you know, going to MMA for a little bit. And then we had Cleo Valentine, the porn star, and they're like, okay. This is what we signed up for. They really are a porn show, which in a lot of ways we are.
Yeah, that's right. When we had Cleo on, I mean, that was great. I thought, hey, this is a big opportunity to get into the porn industry, but no one's contacted us since.
And then we asked her, what's the secret? What do you need to do to be a porn star? And she said, wax your ass. And that's the moment when I knew I wanted to be, my career path was in MMA media, because I'm not.
Yeah, I like my ass hairy. I also don't like to work out, and I like to eat fatty food, so it wasn't going to work out.
Last one from Steve Justino. Looking back on when you first entered the MMA media space, how has your passion for the sport and overall feelings about what you do evolved over time? I'm sure you have seen things from much more behind the curtain point of view since your beginnings. Have certain things made you feel somewhat jaded or disappointed? Have you become more emotionally attached than you thought, perhaps, at following the careers of fighters and seeing the ups and downs of the sport from a front row perspective, so to speak? I guess to sum it up, how... how have your overall feelings about the sport changed since you guys went from fans to pro MMA media mogul superstars? Appreciate that, Steve. We are definitely not moguls, nor are we superstars.
And Dennis, pros as well. Imagine that.
No, we're not pros. No.
It's like an amateur circuit, but we're in the pro. I mean, he is way too kind. This is great. I'm going to put this in my CV, maybe put it as the description of my Facebook page. But, it has been a wild journey for me and Casper. A lot of stuff has happened. A lot of things have sort of... I suppose it changed our perspective on a number of things. I guess I'll kick this off, Casper. Mm-hmm. One of the things sort of stands out in my mind is before, when we were sort of looking from an outset, like a lot of listeners are, a lot of these fighters didn't really seem human to me. I just sort of spoke about them like they were, I suppose, characters in a movie or a TV show.
And now that we've, you know, obviously the biggest source here in Australia and New Zealand, and we've really gotten to know a lot of these Australian fighters, gotten to know about their lives, it's kind of hard to be neutral. I mean, we are neutral, but it's hard because you do care about them, and you do find out about their lives and how much is at stake for these guys when they fight. And I'm talking about a lot of these lower tier type fighters who aren't making that much money and, you know, do need to win their next fight to even stay within the company. So it's been a really interesting experience getting to know these guys. It's been really hard to sort of go from that perspective where they're no longer characters in a TV show, but actual real life people that are right in front of you. And I guess one of the tough things is when you go to an event as media, you're not allowed to cheer or clap or sort of support anyone. You're supposed to be, sitting there. Yeah, stone-faced pretty much, you know.
There's a picture of Fedor, and they're like, this is how you have to look the whole time. And if there's not a picture of Fedor, it's Gegard Mousasi.
That's right, yeah. There's been a couple of times with me and Cash where we've been in the Australian shows, and people have gone crazy for some of these guys that we've really gotten to know very well. And probably one of the hardest things just to sit there and not, you know, not go crazy for them. It's probably one of the toughest things to this day. That I have to always have to remind ourselves. Just sit there. It's like a little smile cracks on the side of your face, and a little, like one of your eyes starts twitching because you can't hold it inside. Yeah. A little bit of blood comes out, trickles out of the ear, you know?
Yeah. No, it's exactly like that. And I'm with you on that as far as humanizing fighters. Like, you know, you see a lot of people on Twitter or YouTube comments or whatever, and they say like, Fighter X, you know, fucking sucks, or they're a pussy, or this and that. And it's like, look, I was never like that, but, you know, people would ask, for example, you know, mates, and you're hanging out, you're just watching MMA, and oh, who do you think would win? You might say like, this person's going to get smashed or whatever. And these days, I'm a lot more hesitant to sort of have that attitude and just be so, you know, dismissive of other fighters. Because, and then there have been times where like, I would look at a certain fighter and I would think like, I don't know, I don't think they'd be very nice in person. And there's just something about their personality, and you speak to them and you have a conversation. It really does humanize them. And it's not just about, you know, caring. It's not like every guest that we have on the show we, you know, care about and we're like, oh, God, I hope everything's cool with their family and whatnot. But after speaking to them, yeah, you do realize that they are a human and you don't really have any will to say anything negative about any fighters, you know? Like, you know, sometimes I see people calling fighters pussies. And it's like, look, you as a fan, you have the right to say whatever you want or go for whoever you want. I mean, that's the beauty and the downside of the internet. But and I'm not saying, hey, everybody do a show, do a podcast so that you can learn or whatever. It is what it is. But I think a lot of those people, if they did, you know, do interviews with fighters or met a lot of the fighters, I think a lot of their opinions would change.
Mm-hmm. Another thing that sort of stands out to me in my head is it sort of went from an experience of sort of being there and being like, oh, wow, we're here, that's all happening, to seeing it sort of run more like a business and fighters going in there just sort of playing their role. You're sort of in the backstage area and it sort of goes from this magical place to a place of everybody just sort of doing their role and doing their thing. And a lot of people write to us and ask us, what's it like being backstage at events? And it's really not as amazing as people make it out to be. I mean, it's a lot of hard work.
It's really stressful.
It's
really,
super
really
stressful. You don't really get to take in what's going on because you're doing so much. There's a lot of expectation from all parties involved. And it's like a crazy bull rush. And especially when we do stuff here in Australia, when an event starts early in the morning, I mean, you wake up like at 6 or 7 in the morning, you get to the arena, and then you do all the fights. You do like the post-fight press conference. You're not done though. Like me and Casper, we work straight through to like 1 or 2 in the morning most times. And if we're lucky, that's when we finish up. They're huge, grueling days, and there's a lot of stuff to get done. So it's definitely not a magical playground where you get to walk in and you hang out with fighters and you have food. The fighters hang out in their own area. They only come in post-fight after the prelims. In the main cards, they usually don't even pop backstage. The post-fight press conference, you know, that happens. But pretty much, it's just a huge strain. It's not like when Homer goes to the chocolate land and runs through and like eats that chocolate dog.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people think that's what it is. And that's what I thought it was. But it's nothing like that at all.
And even like, you know, because at the press conference, you do get a lot of fighters, you get the managers and all these people. But it's like, it states in the rules, as media, you're not allowed to approach them. You know, you can see a fighter that you may idolize or favorite. You can't go there. You can't get selfies. You can't do things like that. Like, yeah, I agree. I think a lot of people listening would think like, oh, being backstage is awesome. And it is. But a lot of it is just very stressful. You know, a lot of times I'm thinking like, you know, when is this video going up? You know, when are we sending this out? What questions am I going to ask? You know, I don't want to make a fool of myself. And leading into that, there's also like when we do post-fight interviews, for example, of all the prelims, that is incredibly difficult because a lot of the fights we haven't even been able to watch. You know, we'll be, say, interviewing Beck Rawlings on a fight that, you know, just finished, but we literally just got done interviewing, you know, somebody else. So we didn't even see most of her fight. So then it's like a big hustle. You got to ask people what happened or all these other things. And then it's just like, it's like a domino effect and you're barely able to watch the fights. You got to, you know, look at things on Twitter and find out what people are reacting to, what you want to ask people about. So yeah. And the other thing is, you mentioned media days. When you watch a lot of these interviews with fighters, like, say, you know, Errol Helwani does a brilliant job of, you know, bringing out personality and character and having a laugh with fighters. But when you see them, it's almost like, it's almost like cattle moving through a farm. You know, it's not like the fighters are bounding into the media room. We're all standing there with the laptops and everything and cameras set up and we're ready to do it. But it's not like the fighters are skipping along and happy, like, yes, we're going to do media day. Mm-hmm. You know, they're cutting weight, they're tired, they've got things on their mind, they sit next to their chair, there's a little plaque next to them with their name and their Twitter handle. And, you know, you approach and you do your thing. And it's, listen, the fighters, for the most part, they're great. You know, they're giving and they're very nice, but you can see it. You can see it in their eyes. They would rather be somewhere else, you know? So when you do watch, you know, interviews where fighters are laughing or having a good time or whatever, props to the interviewer, props to whoever asked that question because they've essentially brought it out of them. It's not like the fighter sitting there going like, oh man, I'm so happy to be sitting here for an hour and, you know, get asked all these, you know, redundant questions that I've already answered a million times on all these other shows. So that's another thing I didn't really realize back in the day when I would watch certain interviews and think, oh, that was a great interview, this fighter was in a good mood. No, the interviewer brought it out of them.
Yeah, and put yourselves in this position, guys. You got two fighters come out at once, maybe sometimes even three, depending on what's going on. And you're in that position where you got to choose between doing this guy or that guy.
Yeah.
Or you might do this one guy and then you want to quickly run over to that other guy. I mean, it's a bull rush. It's the wild, wild west, you know, and it's crazy. I mean, the thing with the media is the media works together and we figure out some great ways to do it. And there really is a sense of camaraderie, I guess, with a lot of guys like MMA Junkie and stuff coming in. But at the same time, it's just crazy. And if you're not on it, if you're not there that second, you might miss out. And that's the thing. There's a lot of pressure that comes when we go to these things because we want to provide the best content we can for you. We don't want to be like, oh, we missed out on Mark Hunt because we were looking away for 2 seconds and another guy came out and we were over there. So it's just a lot of pressure.
I will say that you mentioned the camaraderie. I'm actually surprised that a lot of the MMA media, they're mostly supportive of each other. Like everybody's pretty much friendly, everybody chats. And the crazy thing is you're all in competition. You know, if there's a scrum or a press conference, everybody's getting out the same content, especially if you're doing video content. Everyone's got the same video, but there's no one, you know, trying to be sabotaged. There's no one pulling batteries out of cameras. There's nobody, you know, trying to screw people out of a good view or anything like that. You mentioned MMA Junkie. They're like the dads of like the MMA media. They go to every single event, so they know what to do. You'll come over. They'll tell you, hey, you know, here's a good place to set your camera up. Don't worry about that. So I was actually shocked. I thought that it'd be a lot more competitive. The only time when MMA media get competitive, it's not to do with each other. It's when you get big outlets coming in that are, you know, casual outlets. Like we all remember the disaster of 86 at UFC 193 when all the big outlets came, like Channel 7 and Fox Sports, and they were all like, hey, everybody, move your cameras. And we were all like, stand tall, man. Like brace yourselves for an impact. That was hilarious. And a lot of the major outlets didn't get the footage they wanted because all the, you know, MMA media knew what they were doing and they were, you know, really tight around the Ronda Rousey scrum and everybody else.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, without getting too into it, the mainstream media outlets, they come in, they don't rock up on time. They just come in last second. They expect everybody to move out of their way. And then most of the time, they don't actually use any of the footage in a positive way towards MMA. So I guess it's just a battle of MMA media against mainstream media a lot of the time. But we do band together. And I have to, while we're talking about this, I mean, you mentioned MMA Junkie being like the fathers. You know, we have to give a big shout out to Ken and John Morgan for the great stuff that they do. And we always have fun with those guys and other guys that come down. It's like a bit of a frat, a bit of a group, and we all sort of share stories and have a great time. So great people.
And the other thing that, just before we get off this topic and sort of finish up, the other thing I wanted to mention about that question is, like, this show goes out every week, right? And it's like, what, a two to three-hour show, sometimes a little bit less, depending on what. And you guys, I'm hoping you guys all enjoy it. But just so you guys understand, there is so much that goes into it on a weekly basis. It's not just like we sit down, yeah, boom, 2 hours, and then it goes up, you know, from the organizing the interviews, you know, which is always an incredibly tough thing to do, to researching the interviews, to, you know, to doing the interviews, you know, breakdowns, watching the fights, you know, the technique of the week. There's so much other stuff, you know, wheeling and dealing and organizing other things that, you know, don't even have anything to do with this current week. It might be stuff in the future. It is a huge, huge load of work. So when you guys sort of listen to a 2 hour show, I hope you guys understand there's so much more that goes into it than just 2 hours worth of work every week.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, when we set out to do this show, we always wanted to bring a certain quality of program to you guys. And with that, I mean, it comes a lot of work. I mean, we feel responsible to provide you with the best sort of show that we can. And yeah, obviously very stressful. It's almost like a full-time job just putting this two-hour show together.
All right, we'll get off that topic. Jonathan Messina, because other people have questions as well. And again, info@submissionradio.com. Shoot us an email with your questions. We're going to do these quick ones from Jonathan Messina, and then we're going to wrap up. He says, big fan of the show, I have questions, and they're mostly non-MMA related. Cool. Growing up, who are your favorite fighters, and currently, who are your favorite fighters to watch? Dennis, you first.
Okay, so favorite fighters to watch. Like, I love watching Chael Sonnen. I love watching Brock Lesnar, obviously, now that he's back. I love watching GSP. I loved watching Rampage Jackson. That's from an entertainment perspective. When it comes to actual in octagon work, I love watching Demetrius Johnson. I love watching Tony Ferguson. I love watching Edson Barbosa. I love watching Cowboy Cerrone. I love watching Fabricio Verdum, Frank Mir, and who else? I love watching Mark Hunt, because that's always going to be a huge knockout. And we've actually been ringside and felt, you know, the floor shake with some of those punches. So there's a lot of guys that I like to watch. Sometimes there's guys like a Chael Sonnen who may not be the most exciting fighter, but I love watching them because of the entertainment perspective. And then on the other side of the coin, guys like Tony Ferguson, where Tony Ferguson is entertaining, but the stuff that he's able to do in that octagon, guys like Anthony Pettis, you know, is amazing and just blows my mind. What about you, Cass?
Yeah, so growing up, my favorite fighters to watch were, yeah, Rampage Jackson, Fedor Emelianenko, Wanderlei Silva, Shogun, Anderson Silva, Chris Lieben, Krzysztof Soszynski, because he was like one of the only, you know, Polish guys. Everybody remembers him from The Ultimate Fighter 8. Just a super, super nice guy, pulling all those pranks. He's actually a DJ nowadays. And
you
of
guys
course,
had a nice moment once in Sydney, didn't you?
Yeah. We met him. I had like a Polish scarf. We had a chat about that. And actually, I spoke to him after his fight with, I believe it was Stefan Bonner, and he had like just a mangled eye. And just he could not have been a nicer guy. To this day, easily the nicest fighter I've ever met.
Super nice. And Wanderlei Silva was crazy nice that one time as well. Without going too much into it, he was super nice to fans. And we had spoken to him, and as we were leaving, where we were hanging with him, he actually went out of his way to say goodbye to us.
Yeah. And you know what's crazy? We're watching Wanderlei meeting all these fans, and he's like I haven't seen too many fighters that are standoffish. I mean, even from small names to big names, and obviously MMA's, you know, gotten a lot bigger over the years, but I haven't seen too many fighters that are standoffish. Wanderlei Silva is like the opposite. He will ask fans like, are you good? Did you get a photo? Do you want a photo? It's almost like Wanderlei Silva is coming up to fans. And we saw it multiple times when he was in Sydney for UFC 110. So just one of the nicest guys. Nowadays, favorite fighters to watch. I mean, Luke Rockhold, yeah, he got knocked out. But that's the thing with Luke Rockhold. You know someone's always going to get destroyed, whether it's him or his opponent. I love watching Alistair Overeem fight, Robbie Lawler, Tony Ferguson, you mentioned, one of the most exciting fighters in my book, the Diaz brothers. Frankie Edgar, Stephen Thompson, Carlos Condit, Gunnar Nelson, Michael Venom Page is always must watch TV. Chris Cyborg, Jake Matthews, and Robert Whittaker. Obviously, I've got a soft spot in my heart for those guys because they're Aussies, and I like seeing them do well. John Jones, I love watching John Jones because I literally know that I'm watching greatness in the making, and I know that in years and years to come, John Jones and Demetrius Johnson will look back on and people will just be wowed. I don't know if he'll ever reach, you know, a Muhammad Ali status or anything like that, but
I want to be there to watch all of John Jones's fights and all of Demetrius Johnson's fights so I can say, yeah, listen, when he beat this guy, or when he did this, or when he lost that guy, or, you know, even when he was involved in his hit and run, like, I was, you know, in some way a part of that. I followed that, you know, in real time. Rumble Johnson, how can you not love watching Rumble Johnson? Gustafsson, for the same reasons. Ben Rothwell, always entertaining, whether it's his fights or his cape or anything. Mark Hunt, I love watching Jessica Penne fight. She had just horrible luck in her return recently, but I love watching her fight. Matt Mitrione, and you know, sometimes it's the story going to the fight as well. You know, like, if a fighter is a big underdog and the fight has title implications, you know, I love seeing if that fighter can prevail. That's always exciting to sort of see how far fighters can go. But yeah, those are probably my favorites to watch.
Yeah, definitely. And we'll be in Vegas for all these crazy upcoming shows. So I'm excited to see Jake Matthews going in there, and hopefully we can get a bit of coverage for all you Aussie fans about what's going on in his mind as he's going into that fight.
Jonathan Messina also asked, favorite television show currently on air and all time? Dennis?
It's an interesting one. I sort of flip-flop here and there. I really, there was a point where I used to watch Parks and Recreation all the time. At the moment, I love watching Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
Yeah.
I've gone out.
How good is Brooklyn Nine-Nine?
It's really good. And it's so good that I sort of went out of my way when I started watching it to going around to people who don't watch it and trying to get them to start watching it. But it's a great show. And actually, I've tried to get a couple of people from the cast on this show just as guests.
Really?
So we'll see what happens in the future. But
Can you get Melissa Fumero?
Just... Oh man, that's going to be an in-person interview if we ever have one. We're just going to make sure to, you know, when she's not pregnant, to do that one. But
just a quick story on Brooklyn Nine-Nine. You tried to get me into it, and it didn't work. It didn't take. It was actually UFC 193. We were at your house. We were doing some work, finishing stuff up, and I think we took a quick break. And you're like, I'm going to put Brooklyn Nine-Nine on. I'd never seen the show, but I'd heard people talking about it. And you put it on sort of like mid-season one, and I was like, I don't like this. This is kind of mad. The jokes are kind of forced. I don't know. And you were looking at me, you're like, you don't like it? I'm like, not really. And then months later, this is only a few months ago, maybe 4 or 5 months ago, my girlfriend was watching it on Netflix, and she's like, oh, I'm watching Brooklyn Nine-Nine. I'm like, yeah, Dennis loves that. I'm like, whatever. So I started watching from the first episode, and I got so into it. I called you up a few weeks ago, actually. And I was like, you're like, what are you doing? I'm like, dude, I just finished watching season 3 of Brooklyn. And I don't know what to do with my life anymore. Like,
yeah, it's a great show.
So good. But the characters, they get so much better over time. Like, it's not, I don't think it's really a show that you can kind of watch at any point. Like, you can start from season 2 or 3 or whatever and just go from there. It is actually a continuous show where you have to watch it from the first episode, and you go to watch it in order. It's not like Seinfeld, which you can just watch any episode. But if you haven't watched Brooklyn Nine-Nine, if you're not into it, go from the first episode, and yeah, you'll love it.
See, for us, we do watch it at any episode, but I think you got to watch it all the way through.
But you've already watched it once, yeah? Like, once you watch it all in order, yeah, then you can go back and watch whatever.
To me, it's almost become a Seinfeld. But speaking of Seinfeld, I mean, of all time, that is my favorite show, Seinfeld, because it's just an unreal show, how they're able to it's still relevant to this day when you watch it, you know, it doesn't seem outdated. And I mean, you're having a bad day, blah, 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 or it's on TV, you put your episode of Seinfeld on and have a laugh. I don't think anyone's been able to pull off a show like that since. And I don't think anyone will ever be able to pull anything off like that again. It's just like crazy forces coming together at the right time. And love Seinfeld so much. And you Simpsons, old school Simpsons.
Yeah, I can't look at Simpsons the same way ever since their new episodes. You know who, for me, comes close to Seinfeld? And Seinfeld's definitely on my list. How I Met Your Mother? I love that show. I was actually watching it last night. And for me, that's almost like my new age Seinfeld. Barney Stinson, Marshall, they're the best characters.
Yeah, and then I'm trying to think if there's any other shows that are really...
Entourage?
Yeah, Entourage is a great show. Big fans of Entourage, Johnny Drama.
And that's another show that I almost didn't get into, because here it's on a channel, it used to be on a channel called Arena, which in America is Bravo. And it's kind of like, it's a channel that has a lot of stuff for women. Like, I think you got the new Housewives of whatever, you've got like Shards of Sunset, you've got like cooking shows, you've got like all this Millionaire Matchmaker. It's all things aimed at women. And then I saw Entourage, and I just, because it was on that channel, I thought like, this is going to be stupid. I left it on. It's just one of those things in the background. By the time I saw the second episode, because they had them back to back, I was like, dude, this show is fucking awesome. And I told you and all the other guys. And yeah, ever since then, it's been like our show.
Yeah, for sure. And I really watched that show sort of once every couple of years, I like to actually go from the start and rewatch it because you forget how great it is. Ari Gold, Johnny Drama, so many great characters. And a new one that I'm sort of giving a chance to and I've sort of enjoyed so far, and this is another HBO show, is Bowlers with The Rock, Dwayne Johnson. That's actually a pretty fun show as well. People should check that out and see what they think. It has a bit of an Entourage vibe to it, so I'm waiting to see where it goes. I think season 2 is coming out soon.
Speaking of Bravo and Arena, I love Top Chef. It's the only cooking show that I ever watch, but it's a good show. I'm going to skip right over that. Daredevil, I started watching the first season of Daredevil. That's a really good show. Dark Angel, as a kid, I used to watch Dark Angel with Jessica Alba. That is a really, really good show. I mean, how fitting, right? We're going to Vegas. Las Vegas.
Love Las Vegas. So much. I've rewatched that show from start to finish, I think 5 or 6 times. And I'm in the middle of rewatching it now as well.
Well, I don't know if we've ever...
Because of the big trip.
Yeah, well, I don't know if we've ever discussed this, but you know, I don't know if you've seen the last episode. You know that Las Vegas actually got canceled before they had their finale? So for those, I mean, spoiler alert, and this is like a spoiler that's like 10 years old almost, but Las Vegas, the last ever episode... I don't know, someone's meant to be dead, they come back, someone's pregnant, all this stuff happens, and it ends on a to be continued. But the show was cancelled right afterwards, so they never ever continued that. The show ends, its last ever episode ends on a cliffhanger. How about that?
Yeah.
You know what else? You know what other this is my last one that I'm going to mention because we got to wrap up. You know what other show I love? Archer. Are you a big Archer guy?
No, I'm not a big Archer guy. I got to get into it. I know you always talk about it. And one of the shows that you sort of got me into that I sort of started watching a bit more is Impractical Jokers as well.
Yeah, that's good fun.
That's a good show. But no, I don't really watch Archer very often.
How hard is it poach goddamn egg? I love Archer. It's one of those shows where when you watch it, you want to be Sterling Archer. It's the best. All right, let's move. Do you have any other shows before we move on?
Trying to have a think. Like, there's just a few like shows that I really enjoyed. Some animated shows.
Sounds Dragon Ball Z.
Dragon Ball Z was great. The original X-Men was great. The Batman animated series was great. So yeah, just that kind of stuff. Look, I'm sure some stuff will pop up in my mind. Like, I do watch shows that I don't love, but I think are okay, like Elementary and those types of shows. But for me, I need shows to get me through the week. What I am interested in, I haven't watched this yet, but Rush Hour has a show that's come out, and Lethal Weapon has a show that's coming out. Both of them look really terrible, but I'm still going to give them a watch because I like the movie so much.
All right, last question that we're going to do, Jonathan Messina. Are you guys currently reading any books? If yes, which ones? I'm just going to say no, but I used to read a lot of pro wrestling autobiographies, but not anymore. I don't have enough time for books. Dennis, I know you used to read a lot of books. Are you reading anything now?
Well, the only thing I read is sports autobiographies, and the last book that I read was Mark Hunt's book. And with Mark Hunt going into this Brock Lesnar fight and being more popular than ever, I really hope that you guys go pick up a copy of that book because it is a very, very honest, sort of eye-opening, mind-blowing read that I don't think you'll be able to get from very many autobiographies. I've read a bunch of autobiographies. I have to say, Mark Hunt's book, I mean, he doesn't sort of... I mean, we all remember Brock Lesnar's autobiography. I mean, that thing... It was just a piece of crap. He's just like, that's it. I'm not going to talk about anything else. I'm just going to say this about this subject, this about this subject. And you're like, oh man, are you for real? Like, he skimmed over some really interesting parts of his career in like a few pages. With Mark Hunt, he goes full on into detail about some of the crazy, saddening and also wonderful experiences in his career. So after you read that book, I don't think there's a chance that you'll see Mark Hunt the same way again, especially considering the little amounts of training and the things that he was gone through going into fights. It truly blew my mind.
Last question from Jonathan Messina is Game of Thrones related. I'm just going to skip over that because I'll be honest, I do not watch Game of Thrones.
I tried to give it a go and I didn't like it. I think I'm one of the only people that don't like it, but I'm not a big fan of that time period. I'm not a big medieval guy.
I can't stand anything to do with medieval things. Yeah. I don't like medieval. I don't like things also like, you know, Gladiator, for example. Like, that's a great movie, but I don't like anything set in that time. Like, I watched Hercules with The Rock. That was a horrible movie. Alexander, I walked out of that. I can't stand. Yeah, and medieval, I can't do medieval. I can't do it. I have a feeling that maybe I would get into Game of Thrones, but I'm scared because I just don't have that much time during the week to invest in another show. It's like a family. I only have room enough for so much. And, you know, my family at the moment is Brooklyn Nine-Nine, Archer, Seinfeld, How I Met Your Mother, and there's no room for Game of Thrones.
Yeah. Nah, certainly. I don't know if I'll even pick it up, but how are people so into it and we don't like it? I don't know. Like, it seems like it would appeal to the general cross-section of the public, but maybe I hate for medieval is too strong to ever pick it up.
I think it's definitely too strong. Anyway, that's it, guys. That's another episode in the books. I hope we didn't go over time with those fan questions. But if you have any more, send them in, info@submissionradio.com. Dennis, when are we coming back? We're coming back next week?
Yep, next week we'll be back. Another episode of Submission Radio. Few episodes left, two more episodes until we go to Las Vegas and start covering the craziness that will be UFC 200 and all the other shows like the Tough Finale and the RDA versus Eddie Alvarez title fight, as well as the Hall of Fame ceremony and a bunch of other stuff. So you guys, no better time to subscribe to the channel than now, youtube.com/submissionradioAU. We'll be doing a bunch of stuff there. Super excited. But apart from that, two more episodes to go. So it's going to be a lot of fun going into Vegas. And thanks for joining us here today, guys. It's been another great episode.
We'll catch you guys next week.